bastard. Arms out to your mum's house. 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 Arms out to your mum's house.
Big up.
What is going on?
This is Arms House to Your Mum's House, episode 4. And today is the 24th of November, Thursday, 24th of November, 2022. I got my man here. What's your name, brother? Not my brother, my other brother.
I knew that was going to happen.
Yeah. No, Talal, the bald-headed motherfucker. He has to shut up until I introduce him. I'm talking about my other brother. What's your name?
You can't talk about the boss like that. My name's Theme.
What up, Theme, man?
Theme, malicious, delicious, ambitious, baby. Yes. What's up, everybody?
Easy. Amber right here, man. Again, I just want to thank... I want to thank everybody who's tuned in so far and left a like, left a review, you know what I mean? Giving us a 5-star rating. Please, guys, it helps. It really helps. Like, you might not care about these sorts of things. And to be honest, really honest, I don't give a shit about that stuff either. But... if you like this video or if you comment on it, it's going to reach more people. That's just how the algorithm works. And we live in a matrix right now, party people. So help us out and do that thing, okay? So as you can see, this bald-headed, hairy guy right here, that is actually my younger brother. His name is Talal Karkouti. He is an absolute don. Say hello, Talal.
Hi. Hi there. Thanks for having me. I'm the boss.
I'll tell you now.
You can't do that on camera, Theme. Put that down.
Not, especially not in front of the boss.
Fucking hell.
Imagine that you. Theme is saying Talal's the boss and he's just ripping bongs, rago, in front of him. I don't think that's what you do. No, but when you say Talal's the boss, ultimately this podcast wouldn't be reaching as many people if it wasn't for this dude right here. I mean, I don't know. We were doing this, but we I'm not going to argue with you. It is big time down to my brother Talal. He runs, he produces, he's done a bunch of podcasts in the past. At the moment, he's producing the legendary Alexi Sales podcast. Make sure you go and check that.
The Alexi Sales podcast. And my idea is to kind of begin some sort of kind of network and umbrella of a family of podcasts. And for some reason, I've decided Arms House to Your Mum's House would be the second member of the family.
Yes!
For some strange fucking reason, I agreed that should be the way.
Yeah.
And so, you know, to make this podcast, you know, you're using all my accounts and my softwares and all that shit. So,
yeah, exactly.
And I'm very proud. It's all you, I love the show. I think you guys are smashing it. This is such a funny... I was a bit dubious at first, but... after actually, because so I sat in on the first episode, I was a silent witness. I just sat there and watched you guys do it. I oversaw the first recording. I was laughing my little butt off, and then I kind of just left you guys to it. And as you explained last episode, you
as my brother,
as
my brother, you're used to these conversations. Like, you've heard a lot of these stories before,
but yet I was still very highly amused and entertained, and I think you guys, when you're turned on, in that way, but like when you're turned on, like you really have a great energy and your banter is fantastic.
Can you vouch then, when you were young, when you were little, and we were living in the same house, and when I was older and the house got raided by police and all sorts of mad shit was happening, like, you know, you remember all them times?
Well, that was one mad shit. Yeah.
I remember you. How many times has the house been raided?
I remember you.
How many times?
Once.
Talal, wait. What do you mean once? 3 times the house has been raided, Talal.
Once.
You were too young the first 2 times. The third time, you remember. It got raided twice before that, Talal.
No, the other 2 times he called the police. Get my fucking brother out of this house.
Talal was the snitch.
He's ruining the family.
It would be the least you deserve, man. The reason of hell you put me through growing up.
Yeah. You don't remember, Talal, the first 2 because I was underage. I was under 18. So the police were very respectful when they came to the house. They came at a nice hour and they didn't turn the whole house inside out. But they waited till I was 18.
You were asleep. They dragged you out of bed in your boxer shorts, no?
Yeah. When I was 18. Yeah. That was the third time. That was when they were like, he's an adult now. We're going to fuck his shit up. And that's the one you remember, Talal.
They came
before that.
Yeah, early sparrows fart in the morning.
Yeah, like 6 a.m. Anyway, I didn't want to go off on that tangent.
I remember the other 2 times. That's crazy.
Yeah.
I think you're lying. Maddie's a notorious exaggerator. I'd say like 80% of his stories are Talal, 60% false.
There's exaggerating and then there's lying. Don't let a good yarn get in the way of a story. What's the saying? I don't know what to say. No. I'm not bullshitting. Genuinely, Talal, we've been raided. The house here got raided 3 times. Anyway, that's by the by, and it's not a gloat on my behalf. I was just trying to get Talal to vouch for me, and he just completely threw me in the fucking deep end. Yes?
Talking of getting raided, I used to work at this restaurant in Twickenham as like a waiter, and I worked with this really posh dude who lived kind of close to where I lived.
Yeah, in Twickenham. So one time,
I was going to give him a no, but we both lived in like Hammersmith. So I drive him all the way back. And for some reason, I had a 9-bar of skunk in like a Sainsbury's bag. You know how you always used
just
to
for
be
some
like
reason.
Sainsbury's bag. Yeah, but I had it at work. I must have just picked it up beforehand and went to work, did my shift and shit, and said to this guy, "Do you want to lift back?" And he's like, Yeah, thanks very much. Get
in
the
car. He could smell it in the car.
He could smell it was on his seat. Yeah. So I was like, "Oh shit, I've got this. And I have to put it underneath my seat." Yeah, I've got a tiny Peugeot 205. Remember 205?
Put
the 9-bar under the seat, and we just drove. Down the A316.
Wait. Theme. A 9-bar. For people who maybe not so experienced with drugs and weed and dealing weed and stuff, a 9-bar is how many ounces? How many ounces?
Nine ounces. That's what they
nine
call it.
Nine ounces. And what's so that what? Kilos? Yeah, okay.
So 2 bars
an ounce
is half a key. 4 bars is a key. Okay.
And what's that in pounds?
Nine kilos. Pounds?
Don't listen to that. Is that in how much is that in liters?
Yeah, exactly. Anyway, back in the day, I used to ticket for $1,000.
Yeah,
so this dude Shane in Acton Estate.
You were getting skanked, man. I was getting 9-bar for 900.
Imagine getting it grand now.
Yeah,
for
yeah.
Nine, oh, like they're talking like you know what I mean, it's punk.
Mm.
Anyway, drove by the A316. The whole bill, they just came behind the car. No blues and twos, no flashing, nothing. Just one of those ones when they just sit behind for the entire journey, like over, what's it, Barnes Bridge, Chiswick Bridge, coming into, I'm thinking, holy shit.
Oh, man.
And he is absolutely fucking bricking it, this kid. Yeah. Like he's because it stinks, and I showed him the 9-bar, because I'm showing, look what I've got, fucking hell, I'm well after, you know what I mean? I'm showing him this thing. The police, so I think, fuck it, I'm going to go to where my mum and dad live, just pretend I'm going straight there. I turn down these left and rights down these little like residential streets and the police follow. And I'm thinking, holy fucking shit. And I'm leading them directly to my mum and dad's house. Yeah, because now I'm like praying it out. Like, fucking hell, where am I going? Fucking hell. And I go into the street. There's no cars there ready. So I just park in next to the curb. And the police, then they turn the blue and they park bang outside your door. As in the car door, so you can't open the door and run.
Yeah.
Because they just thought I was like some fucking chieftain. But I like think, what the
fuck
am I going to
do? You had a Peugeot 206. That was the car of choice.
Yeah, 205.
Or 205, sorry.
XS. Boy Sport or something.
Yeah.
So dope. But so they pulled up I've pulled into the pavement. They've pulled up and just stopped like inches away from my door so I can't open the door. Yeah. The classic police tactic. So then they come round to the car, and then because their car's right next to my window, they have to kind of lean over the bonnet. So they're kind of leaning into the car like this. She's like, wind down the window. And the 9-bar, he's on my side. The 9-bar's under my seat. And it's just wrapped in one fucking Sainsbury's bag. I'm thinking, fuck it. Now, as soon as I open the window, it's going to be, what the fuck is that smell, you couple of cunts? Yeah. And this geezer is bricking it. Like, I've never seen. I'll have to look at him to say, like, listen, man, just act casual. Yeah, I was going to do like the whole like act casual thing. Looked at him. There's like just shit coming out of him, out of all holes. It's just fucking just shit. And I'm like, yo, but you got to calm the fuck down. But because I'm looking at him and kind of shouting at him, the policeman is now thinking, what the fuck? Because he's at the window. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He's like, wind the window down, son. Wind the window down. So I'm like, As soon as I wind this window down, I'm nicked. I'm going to jail.
He's going to get a big waft.
1 meter from his nose. Because he's on my side.
Yeah.
He winds down the window. So what are you doing? I'm just like, I'm going home. He's like, where's your house? And I'm like, that one. I point to my mum and dad, yeah?
Yeah.
And he's like, right, so if you get out of the car, you're going to walk to that house. And I'm like, start realizing what his thing is. He doesn't think we live there. And I'm like,
He thinks you're 100%.
Like thinking any minute now he's going to fucking smell it. He's like, right, I want you to get out and walk to that house. And don't pick up anything. And I'm like, well, I've got to get my keys. He's like, well, get your keys. So I take the keys out of the ignition.
Yeah.
Thinking, fucking hell, I'm leaving the 9 bar in the car. This is fucking perfect, yeah?
Yeah.
Because the one you see open that door. I see these things, I'm going to fucking rob the house. And I open the door.
Yeah.
And close the door. And I just stand in my hallway, like, thinking, what do I do now? And I'm like, thinking, holy shit, they're going to be chatting to him and stuff. He's blatantly going to say, he's got a 9 bar under the fucking
seat. Oh, your mate,
yeah. Yeah, but he's not my mate. He's like some dude I work with.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean? I've worked there for, like, a couple of months. And thinking, holy shit.
Yeah.
So I come outside the house and he's just standing outside getting a bollocking, and they come over and they say, oh, right, do you know why? I can't remember what they said, but they didn't say shit. They didn't say shit.
Yeah, they were just, you know,
they matched off, the description of someone they're looking for.
Yeah.
Man. Yeah. And just left me.
They left.
Yeah.
I remember thinking, holy fuck, opening the car, taking a 9 bar of skunk.
Yeah.
Going in the house.
You just reminded me of like, I've been in the car a couple times with people where we're driving and everything's cool and, you know, whatever. And then we look in the rear view and there's a police car behind. And then the dude driving is just like, oh, yeah, put this under the seat. And I'm there like going, what the fuck are you talking about? And he's putting it under my seat. And I'm like, what the fuck are you putting under my seat? God damn it. That's happened a couple of times. But yeah, then so usually funny. Police, they're just trying to, you know, they're just That's trying to. So funny.
And you know when you want to get the reputation, you want to be the bad man. Yeah, you want to be the bad man. There's always that one crew where you're the baddest man in the crew. You feel like quite a big bad man. I'm in this crew now. That means I'm the biggest bad man in this crew. In other crews, I'm not such a bad man. I used to travel a lot with my friend Sam Jacobs. Yeah, big up Sam. He listens to the podcast and that. He fucking loves it. Big up Sammy J. And he, one time we were driving back, I think it was with Buds as well. There's all crew from Richmond College. Sammy's driving a purple KA. Yeah, big up Buds, man, every time.
Yeah.
Purple KA, purple Ford car, whatever you call it.
Yeah.
We're on A316 again, coming back from Richmond College. And there's me with like my new fresh skinhead, like sitting in there, Reebok Classics. I'm in the middle back seat of the car.
Yeah.
And all the other seats are full. And he's like, rawr! We get pulled over, pull over to the side, and the policeman just comes to the door. Sammy winds down the window, and Sam will vouch for this. I hope he leaves a comment on some shit. The policeman puts his head in the door and just looks down to the back of the car, goes, you. Just points to me in the middle of the car. There's full seats, and I'm like, what? Get out. No way, man. Like, they searched me and everything. They just completely left everyone else in the car.
They just singled you out. There's
didn't chat to the driver. We didn't do anything wrong. We were just driving. Sam did nothing wrong.
Yeah.
And he's like, you, get out. Oh, my fucking hell.
It's plainly because you were dressed in an Avarex. You were the only one in the Avarex with
the little white skinny kid with like his fresh skinhead.
Yeah, exactly.
Like polo, Ralph Lauren sport jumper. You know what I mean? Like Reebok Classic gum sole, like trying to be well hard. And I'm thinking, shit.
I swear a lot of these police, they were just fucking just trying to fill the time, man. I mean, the amount of times I got pulled over as well, and like for half an hour, 45 minutes, a big rigmarole, and then they just go, all right, here you go, you can go now. Well, like, what the fuck was the point in all that, you know?
Yeah,
but then that would be like the highlight of our night. We'd be like, hey, we got pulled over. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Anyway,
Talal. Yeah.
The only time I've ever been in trouble with the police
yeah,
is if like... I've really asked for it, or someone is
like what? Give us an example.
Because I don't think I have like a guilty look, or like the clothes I wear don't make me look like a guilty, like fucking scary rude boy or anything. But I'm just sometimes the complete fucking idiot and just get my. I used to smoke a lot of draw and like just doing it in really obvious stupid places. Like when I was at uni, I remember.
Which uni did you go to?
I was on. Manchester, I went to Sussex Uni. I was in
Sussex,
living in Brighton, and I was on the. I was at a house party. It was like uni time, so there was a house party in the middle of the week. It wasn't a weekend, And I was coming on the bus home at like 7-8 in the morning. And I was out of it, completely fucking, you know, eyes in the back of my head, like I had no idea what was going on. And I had one zoot left in my pocket. So I skinned it up on the top deck of the bus. And then and the bus is like a 2-minute walk to my house. I got off the bus and just straight away, I'm so fucking nonchalant, don't give a fuck. Got off the bus, just straight away lit the spliff and just started walking.
Yeah.
As soon as I lit it, I just hear woo woo like that. And there was a police car right next to me on the street.
Yeah. It's funny how they do that, man.
Yeah. I was like, whoa, fuck, what? And he gets out of the car, he goes, are you stupid? And I go, what are you doing? What do you mean? He goes, are you fucking stupid? Give me that. He takes the spliff, and then I realize, I look around me, and there's like school kids everywhere. They're all like on their way to school.
Yeah,
and I'm remembering like being on the bus. I'm remembering that I was surrounded by fucking school kids all on their way to school and shit.
Being
I was
just
oblivious to everything, man. I was just completely in another world. In another fucking world.
Yeah,
and I looked
around
and goes, oh, of course. And then a policeman took me, he's like, come over here, and he wanted to search me. He took me over, and there was like this building next to us that had like scaffolding on it, and he like, put your hands there, and he told me to put my hands on the scaffolding, and then he took the spliff. For some reason, he just like balanced it carefully on one of the scaffolds, like that. He just went,
yeah.
He goes, all right, come on then, and he started searching me. I was like, oh, mate, come on. And then I'm like, please, mate, come on, man. I live right there. He goes, shut up. He's like, search me. And then he went down to search my fucking shoes and socks. You know, they stick their fingers in your socks
shoes.
And while he was down there, I just like thought I was being well slick. Like, you know, when you're that drunk in your head, you're imagining yourself being really smooth. But then like, if anyone was looking at you, you're just a sloppy drunken mess. Yeah. Fucking grabbed the spliff quick as a flash. I just went, huh! And I shoved it down my pants. took the spliff and like shoved it down my pants, thinking
he was down.
Yeah, thinking he wouldn't notice. And he stood up and he looked at me, goes, you fucking idiot. And then like put these like, rubber gloves on. You fucking idiot. He said to his partner, get us a bag. And she went and got an evidence bag. And he like reached into my pants and was like, fiddling around my
hairy
testicles.
Your dirty, hairy, stinky
balls. That was the dumbest move ever, because I'm thinking if he was going to be cool about the zoo, if he balanced balancing it on scaffolding, that's pretty difficult. Balance the zoo, most of them would rip the zoo up and like throw it in front of your face, go, look what you're going. It goes on the floor. He balanced Talal's zoo on the thing. Maybe he was just going to say, right, get your zoo and fucking go home. You know what I mean?
Yeah, probably.
You upped it by grabbing it and sticking it down your pants.
And I started begging him. I was like, please, officer, I'm so sorry. Look,
it's
man.
It's my last zoo.
I said, it's my last zoo, man. I'm telling you, it's my last zoo. And I live right there. Like, in a minute, I'm going to be inside my house, not bothering anyone. I'm sorry. I'm just in a zoo.
Yeah.
I'm in another world. I wasn't thinking. I'm sorry. He goes, shut up. He puts it in the evidence bag. He goes, fuck off. Go on.
What is he? Was he in a movie by
Guy Ritchie?
Was he in a Guy Ritchie?
You slag.
You shut up.
You fucking what? Put that zoot in your pants, did ya?
Well, you smoking the ping pong tiddly.
You think I'm afraid of getting in your pants? Come on.
So did you get arrested?
No, he just told me to fuck off before he fucking changes his mind.
It's mad when they don't arrest you.
He's like, I can't be arsed with you, mate. You better fuck off right now. And he put the spliff in the evidence bag and just walked off. I was so gutted. Damn. I remember another time I got searched and
wait, because okay, you reminded me of a story, man, and it was in Ealing. Yeah, this was like maybe early 2000s, and we were in the Rat and Parrot pub. It no longer exists. I don't know what it's called now.
Rat and Parrot? Where was that?
It was called the Rat and Parrot. It was down Bond Street was here, and it was the other street where it met, like coming up to South Ealing, next to Ealing Broadway's Ealing Broadway Shopping Center. Little pub.
Yeah.
Anyway, so we're all in there getting wasted or whatever, and my mate at the time was going out with this guy,
yeah, who was, he got involved in the crew. His name was Ed. Yeah, but the dude had severe learning disabilities.
Dillabilities.
He had mad dillabilities, yo. No, he had mad. No. He was a super cool, kind-hearted, nice guy, but the guy had serious, like, social anxiety and issues and whatever. He was cool with me. I was cool with him, but I remember seeing him getting it. He would just say the wrong thing at the wrong time. He was like one of them types of dude. He didn't mean to do it, but he just kind of,
I like,
he was just one of them dudes. His name was Ed, but everyone used to call him Dickhead.
It's not even funny.
It's like, this is a long time ago. This is when we were teenagers. Yeah. And no one said it to his face.
It's so funny.
Obviously, no one said it. But the dude, I remember the guy, like, he would turn up at the park and we'd all be on our bikes and he'd turn up in the park and go, hey, check me out, guys, and try and do a wheelie and then end up fucking, like, falling off the bike. And we'd just be like, yo, man, why? Like,
you're making it sound like a movie when he's trying to become bread. Yo, check me out.
Yeah, check it. I'm being serious. Anyway, so we're in the Rat and Parrot, and then I'm like, okay, I looked at the time, it was 10 to 11. So I knew 11 o'clock, ding, 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 last pints, all that stuff. So I was like, okay, we're all going to be out in the street in a second. I'm going to go to the toilet, roll a quick spliff, yeah, roll a quick zoot, so that when we go out, boom, we have a little zoot. Because that was the time when you'd all go to a pub, and then you'd all be standing outside the pub for an hour. After the
Who's
pub
got
closed.
Free house?
Who's got free house? Where are we going? Where are we going? Yeah, everyone just sitting around for fucking eight. You remember them days, yeah?
Yeah.
So boom, I got. Well, yeah, maybe, yeah. But no, I don't know. I don't know if I get involved in that anymore. But so I went toilet, build a zoo, and then 11 o'clock, ding, ding, ding. And then I look at Ed and I'm like, yeah, let's go bun this zoo. So we all go outside, and Rat and Parrot in the front was the road, and then there was a little alleyway, and then there was the back bit where all the skaters used to skate in the entrance to the car park to Ealing.
Oh, yeah, I remember that. Oh.
I think the post office thing, whatever. Anyway,
post office.
Yeah, there was no skaters there. This was, like I said, this was 11 o'clock at night. So we went back there. So we're sitting there, me and Ed.
I remember that being a plot.
Yeah, we were just passing the suit back and forth, chatting about whatever, and then I just look up. Excuse me, guys. Sorry. Akit doesn't like when people burp on.
Yeah, you're making us lose fucking listeners, man. My sister,
Akit.
We don't want to lose you for that.
Salute, well, Akit.
Don't worry,
I can't help it.
Edit
sometimes I put
that out.
I'm not going to spend the time editing this shit out. Okay. So we're back there, bunning a zoo. I look over my shoulder, and boom, it's a fucking squad car, whatever you call them, a police car. Just rolling in really quiet, slowly into the big wagon. And I'm like, oh, shit. I see it instantly. I go, fling, and I fling the zoot off, yeah? And then they just park the car. They get out of the car. They pick the zoot off the floor. They saw me do that thing. They pick it up. They break it into bits, and they're like, yeah, look, it's got weed in it. Oh, you guys, you sit in this. And then instantly, I was like, yeah, we smoke. There's a zoot, yeah. It was weird. Sorry, guys, because I knew I had nothing on me. That was
and
literally
then they beat
my,
the shit out of me.
I forgot to add that to the story. That's all I had was that zoot. So yeah. I knew I had nothing on me. So I was like, "Yeah, it's a spliff. You got me. It's a fair cop, governor. no worries, you know." And then they were like, "Okay, you know, you come with me." And they took me off to one side. And then it was a male cop and a female cop. Yeah. And the male guy, he was an Indian guy, he took me off to the side. And then the lady took Ed to the side, yeah? And, they, you know, it's standard procedure. They asked us where we've been, what we're doing. And I was like, look, and Ed, I assumed he saw me be just being honest, because I was with him when I was just like, yeah, it was a zoo, you know, so what? Because I know in my head, at the end of the day, what the fuck they're going to do to a half burnt out zoo, you know what I mean? Like, it's nothing, even back then. And so the male cop takes me off, and we're chatting. I'm like, yeah, I got, no, he searched me, nothing on me. I was like, yeah, sorry, mate. I'm literally going home now, you know, and I wasn't even that drunk, you know what I mean? I was just, and he was just like, yeah, cool. No worries. Let's just see what my partner says. And we look over
to my man Ed and this female cop. And instantly, as we look over, she goes, grabs my mate, dashes him up against the car, puts the handcuffs on him, and ducks him into the car.
What's he got?
And I'm like, what the fuck? And I look at the guy, and he was like, oh, man. He was like, oh, mate, my, like, I'm going to have to arrest you too.
No.
And I was like, why? What happened? What the fuck did he say to her? I don't know what the fuck Ed said to this woman. Yeah,
he didn't have anything on him. He didn't have like a weapon. Well, check or this. What she made the switch?
She didn't find nothing on him. I don't know. He said something that just pissed her off, man.
And let me touch your cho-cho.
To this day, I doubt he would have said something like that. He wasn't a pervy guy, but he would have just said something off key to her. And then she would have just, and we were watching it, and the male policeman looked at me and he was like, I'm sorry, mate. Like, my partner nicked him, so I'm going to have to nick you. Yeah. And I'm like, for what? And they're like, for possession of marijuana. I'm like, fuck's sake. So, boom, they arrest me, but they don't cuff me or nothing. He just puts me in the car. And I'm sat next to Ed in the back of this police car. We're driving to Acton Police Station.
What the fuck
station.
Did you say, you fucking idiot?
So boom, exactly. I'm going to him. What the fuck did you do? And he's there, like, cuffed up, going, I didn't say nothing. And then he looks at me, and he's like, go like this. And I'm like, what? And he's like that. And he had balls. He had a weed in his balls. I had no idea. Yeah, and he was wearing tracksuit bottoms, and he was basically signaling that his weed had dropped out of his balls and it was got down his leg. So
did you clock the signal straight away?
Like, I could clock that he was trying to tell me and stuff, but like just on the slide, and I was like, look, just
and the two police are in the front, or one police?
They're in the front, and we're driving to the police station. So boom, I grab the thing. Yeah. And I'm like, look, I'm not having it on me. So I end up putting it in his sock. I just put it in his sock and I shove it. No, the windows were up. I just shoved it in his sock. And then then we go police station. They write up a whole report. They end up putting us both in the cell together. And I'm like, you still got that weed on you? He's like, yeah. And then we end up building a suit in the cell.
Shut up.
We didn't smoke it. We didn't smoke it in the cell. But we ended up just, you know, doing our, like, statement. We had to fill in the statement. I was like, yeah, you caught us running a zoo. Nice. Well done, guys. And we're in the fucking police station in Acton on a Friday night. There was people coming in with blood all over their faces. Someone be getting wrestled to the floor. And me and Ed just sitting there.
Him
cuffed up like that, and me just sat next to him, just going, "What the fuck's sake, sweet? What the fuck are we doing here?" You know, we were there for a couple of hours, and they let us go, and we bun that zoo on the way home, me and Ed. But it was just—I just remember thinking at that point when we were in the police station, and there was madness going on. It, like, people getting wrestled, like I said, blood splattered on the floor, like crazy on a Friday night, and me and him sat there like taking up the policeman's time over a half a zoot that they caught us bunning behind a pub somewhere, you know? To this day, like I said, I have no idea what the fuck Ed said to that woman. I have no idea what he said, but he must have said something fucked up.
Pigs like you that make this country a piece of shit. I hope you burn in hell. You fucking hideous wretch. He must have said something. You're coming down to the station with me, buddy.
All right, party people, listen.
She kung fu'd his ass. Yeah.
You know what happened to me the other day?
No, tell us.
No, Talal, don't start guessing. Listen to this.
Guess. You bought some nipple tassels.
No. Close.
You rode a donkey for the first time.
No. Check this out. Yeah. I work for an events company, and there was an event happening at a hotel near Canary Wharf, and the hotel's called Tribe Hotel. Mm-hmm. And so I'm there setting up in the lobby. It was like the opening of the hotel, but it was a month late because the Queen died. It was supposed to happen a month earlier, but the Queen died, so they had to postpone it for a month. Anyway, well,
was she organizing the party?
She died.
Is that what it was?
She just died. She died, so they couldn't do the party, you know, out of respect.
Yeah.
Anyway, I'm there setting up. I look over. I swear to fucking God. Yeah. I look over and I see KRS-One.
Oh, shit.
I've met him a couple times before. I've shook his hand a couple times. I've seen him live a couple times. But I was there working. I looked over my shoulder. He was there. in the flesh.
What was he doing?
We had a couple. Well, he's in England at the moment touring. He's going around.
Was he staying in that hotel?
He was in Birmingham. He was staying at that hotel. And I just happened to be there when I was like, oh shit. And he saw me, he looked at me, I was like, oh my God. And he was like, yeah, man. I shook his hand. I was like, big up. But I was working, you know what I mean? So yeah. I couldn't go completely fan mode. I was like, man, you're a legend, man. Salute. Big up. You know, but he was in the middle of something. I was in the middle of something, and it was just like went off. And then about an hour later, boom, he walks up again. He comes up and he's like, yo, man, you want to get a photo, man? Let's get a photo.
He asked you for a selfie. Like,
He could tell. That is brilliant. He could tell I wanted one.
Yeah.
That's what the beauty of the guy, man. He could tell I wanted one because he could see I was working, and, you know, he could sense I didn't want to put him out. You know what I mean? Or whatever. And so I was respectful, but then he came over and he was like, let's get a photo, man. Come on, man. And then I swapped email with him. I gave him my card, you know what I mean?
KRS1@gmail.com.
No, imagine he's KRS36@hotmail.com because he couldn't get the one.
Yeah.
He wasn't quick enough.
And did he, when he took the picture, were you
I
like,
I gave him my.
In my, my camera phone in my hand, I will hold. Turn it round the shutter button, yeah, I will hold. Press the little button and the pose we hold.
Hold. I love that tune. That's a tune called Hold by KRS-One. I love that tune. But anyway, that was a random thing that happened the other day, man.
Lucky.
I was
well cool. Boosted with that. What did his dick taste like?
And if you want to see the picture of me and What did you say?
What did his schlong taste like?
It was, you know, had a bit of barbecue to it, a little bit of salt. No, I'm sorry, man.
When you were at the... I know you talked...
Cut that shit up.
When you were at the Zulu Nation... Because he's Zulu Nation, right?
No, he's not.
Yeah, he's a nonce as well, yeah.
No, he's not Zulu. No.
Is he not? I thought you meant Maddie. I thought you meant Maddie was Zulu Nation.
Is he not?
A nonce.
No, technically, he's from the temple of hip-hop. And Zulu Nation, they're not against each other, but they're not the same thing. Yeah. And so he's never really been, he knows all them boys. And not to get too deep into the whole noncing thing. I mean, you know, at the end of the day, the word nonce gets thrown around willy-nilly nowadays.
Get a nonce!
I don't like
the way. Well, they're not all nonces. It's just Africa Bombard,
of course not.
Isn't it? Imagine Zulu Nation was some
fucking nonce ring. It's not been... Well, ultimately, Afrika Bambaataa is Zulu Nation.
Yeah,
he's
horrible.
The head of it. You know what I mean? So it does tar the whole thing. And let me explain to the people listening who might not know. I mean, again, I don't want to go too deep into this. Maybe one episode in the future, we will go deep into this.
They should watch the comedy video we did where we mentioned...
Oh yeah,
Afrika Bambaataa was my dad before we became a nonce.
Yeah. You know what I mean? Just there have been accusations against Afrika Bambaataa. Afrika Bambaataa, if you don't know, is one of the stalwarts of hip hop. One of the original founding, one of the original founding members of what we call hip hop nowadays. You know, he was definitely one of the guys who laid
original
the foundation.
Nonce.
His records, like, you know, a lot of
NFL,
the
NFL noncing for life.
Yeah.
Anyway, ultimately now there's been big accusations against Afrika Bambaataa from I think nine people so far have come out and said that they were molested by Afrika Bambaataa back in the 60s and 70s, but because of the statute of limitation in America,
lot
of the accusations, they haven't even made it to a court of law. He can't get off something that doesn't even make it to court.
I thought he was like in prison now.
No, Talal, there is one account
that's more recent.
It's accusing him. That is more recent, that is actually going to make it to the law, to a court case. And obviously these things are very long and drawn out.
Statute of limitations shouldn't be a thing. If the victim is still alive, then there shouldn't be a statute. Like, if the guy died 50 years ago, they'd be like, okay, what can we do about it? But if the guy is still alive and living with his trauma, then they should be like, still statute to limit what? Of course, let's take him to court. Have you got any evidence?
But there is a reason for the statute. I don't know what it is right now, but I'm sure there is a reason. You know, I think once you reach a certain amount of time, I have no idea. I'm not a lawyer or anything like that. But I think once it gets to 30, 40 years, then the evidence loses a certain amount of credibility because of the amount of time that has passed. You know what I mean? And so for a jury to justly convict someone, you know, it's all long-winded and crazy. And like I said, I'm not a lawyer, so...
The UK doesn't have statute of limitations.
I'm sure there is a version of it here, but I don't know.
I'm just Googling this shit now.
But there's also... I tell you what freaks me out about American law system is...
5 years. 5 years. The statute of limitations is the time limit for filing charges against the defendant.
In America, it's 5 years.
Well, I got...
5 years. The government can no longer file criminal charges for an offence once 5 years has passed.
Did you know, it's not well known, but in New York, next to the Statue of Liberty, there's a smaller statue called the Statue of Limitation. And it's just a guy standing there going, forget about it.
He's like, use that pose like that. Yeah. What do you want me to do?
Forget about it.
Hey,
it's the Statue of Limitations.
He's the Statue of Limitations. I like that. Anyway, Talal, you've been chatting to your
missus. I was telling B about this podcast, and she goes, what's it about? Yeah. I said, well, like, the kind of the theme of the show.
What is it about?
I said, the theme of the show is, like, about growing up in the 90s and graph and hip-hop, and that's kind of the theme of it.
Yeah.
And she goes, oh, cool. And
then London, like, culture.
And then so, and I was... She goes, so what were they talking about on this one? I was like, oh, they talked about Andy's wedding. And she goes, wasn't that last month? And I go, yeah. And she goes, well, that's... So instantly they've gone off the topic.
Yeah, it's true.
She got really angry.
It's true.
She goes, what the fuck's up with these amateurs? What are they...
No, no,
and
no.
Then my mate said, haven't you ever heard...
Does she get really...
Haven't you ever heard a man with a podcast before? Like, they don't have to stick to anything. They just talk
well,
about...
Well, no, Talal, I think what you did wrong, we don't talk... We don't have to, as a rule, talk about graffiti
and
hip hop.
Yeah.
It's we are graffiti heads and hip hop heads
I
talking
about say, we are
whatever.
Graffiti and hip hop.
We are.
No, yeah, I said, yeah, that's just kind of a launching pad where they go from there. But I had an idea. I was wondering, is it too late to change the name of this this show?
It's, oh, I love the name and I love the music
the
that Manny's done.
The episode on the show. Yeah, go on, Talal.
I'm joking, but I think you should call the show "Back in the Day" because all you ever I was listening.
Heard it.
I've listened to all the episodes so far, and it's fucking great. But then I just caught myself. I just realized, like, oh my god, give him another 20 years, and you're 80% of what you do on this show is back in my day. It wasn't like this. It was like that. And then you would say why things were better or worse back in your day. And you're just complaining. 40p, we could get on a bus for 40p back in my day. Back in my day, there were no mobile phones. Back in my day, Spotify's rude music. Back in my day. Back in my day, Kanye West was good. Back in my day. And it's just, that's all this show is. And I want to fast forward 20 years, that like, or 30 years, have you two be proper old men. And like, how it's just, I'm just like,
and we'll be complaining about today. We'll be complaining about
it doesn't matter what you complain about, but like, it's just you because it's such a stereotype of old men, of old people to go, it was back in my day, it was a lot better. And then you come out
doing it so much.
No, I think that I step in every now and again. I push back a bit and I give it up for the young ones.
Of course.
No, but the last two episodes I've listened to, I've caught myself saying, yeah, but back in the day, you know what I mean? Yeah, but back in the day. And I've heard that sentence about 10 times in the last one.
Yeah, that's why I was saying you should change the name to back in my day.
Yeah,
but I think it's too generic. The name of your podcast is fucking perfect. Never change it. But
And that phrase. That's an old school phrase as well. That's from back in the day. So, you know, yeah. I think it's suitable. But yo, listen, guys. So sometimes every now and again.
I've got so many stories to tell while I've been listening to your stories. That's the best thing. It makes you think of something else. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Write them down, because if you don't mention them, we'll bring them up in the future, man. No doubt.
They were just about
that's one thing.
Stories about getting ripped.
Arms house to your mum's house. To your mum's house.
So listen, we're gonna start off with this tune. I think we'll start with one of, because I've got two from Theme and one from Talal, so I'm going to start with one from Theme, go to
you
Talal's.
You cut out the only tune that I had something to say about, by the way. Just remember.
Well, we'll play it next time. All right? Theme us, I'm sorry.
Remember cause... Leper, Black Dave, and White Dave? And the guy who used to write
Leper. Anything. No. It's too late now, guys. Yeah, we can do it in the future, okay, guys? Come on. Let's just keep
it. He used to live next door to this guy, and this guy was having a massive cocaine party with LTJ Booker. But yeah, friend.
No, 100%, we need to hear that, Themos. Just not today, okay? Because we're already good. We're making good time, and we've got a couple more to go through. And I think we got a lot to talk about on these ones as well. Especially
that's a shout for Matt Script. Matt Sick would have definitely heard that. That you've already mentioned. No, we're running on for quite a good time now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He's looking to shut down the podcast already.
I know. Let's give a couple of shout-outs to people that have shown some love so far. Ooh. I've got messages, and Theme has got messages from a couple of heads that have been showing some love for the podcast so far. Thank you, guys, for checking it out. Big up, Matt.
Yeah, man.
Sick. Salute.
One of the sickest writers out there. Sickest artists.
Oh, you've been actual getting graph people have been watching the show.
Yeah. Necker. Bad boy writer.
Showed some love.
Who else has been
showing
some love?
Has Gary said anything?
No, but Roy.
Gary, did Gary say anything?
No, not Gary, but Royd. The other person I mentioned,
his brethren.
His brethren. He actually said, yo, that was very respectful and that was cool. And I loved your insight, you and Theme. He said, I love your graph. I love that you guys keep it old school and like the traditional, he called it traditional style.
Yes,
he
letters, said, bruv. He's letters,
got,
bruv.
He's got a mad soft spot for that, but he appreciated what we said. And I said to him, look, I hope we've been respectful and, you know, it's not a disrespect.
Yeah, it was very respectful, an opinion. Apart from the segment being called Wackest Writer of the Week.
Exactly. Well, we do that for you know, hyperbole. What do they call it?
Hyperbole.
Hyperbole, hyperbole. Hyperbole. Yeah.
What the
ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the hyperbole.
The pterodome. But anyway, who else has shown some love, man? Asthma has shown
Moxie
some love.
George has shown some love. Moxie hasn't reached out.
Moxie, he's a dapper, of course.
I love the way you mention Asthma and George together, like they're good brethren listening together. You know, Asthma and George, they've been sitting.
Don't mention that. Moving swiftly on.
Yeah, let's get on with these. Songs.
Thank you again. Thank you everyone for getting involved. Let's get into this first tune. This is Theme's first tune. I want to hear Talal's reaction.
Do you
he
ever
probably
do
knows
this. When
this.
You have like a tape measure, do you ever try and use it as a yo-yo? Like, do you ever play with it like a yo-yo?
Sometimes I measure stuff for no reason.
Maybe when I was 4 or 5 years old, maybe. Right. But anyway, Talal.
Yeah,
check this out. Have you ever heard of Stevie Ray Vaughan?
Well, yeah, the guitarist.
Yeah, the guitarist. Yeah, this is a.
Of course he has, man.
I know. Yeah, Talal is an avid. Oh shit! This is a cover.
He's fucking dog shit.
This is a cover of Little Wing. Check it out. Guys, I need the toilet. I'm going to leave you with this. Give me 30 seconds.
Mute your mic. Mute your microphone, Maddie.
So we can't hear him piss over Little Wing.
We don't want to hear Maddie pissing over Little Wing. That would be...
I love this version.
Stevie Ray Vaughan...
He doesn't sing.
Does he ever sing? He only ever plays, right?
No, he does that. He does sing. Yeah, definitely. That Texas tune, I can't remember. But now Jimmy would sing, but Stevie kind of plays it.
Yeah. That's great.
It's got a way, it's got, like, Jimmy's kind of crazy with it. This is, like, really soulful. This is, like, an ode to Jimmy, you know what I mean?
Sure, what like, year
I feel
did
sorry
this
that
come
we miss
out?
You.
Know?
No, I'm going to Google it now. But it is fucking incredible. And when he starts, like, the solo bits and stuff, it's unbelievable, man.
So what do you think?
to get when the tune really starts kicking off, which it was just about to then, yeah. Man, he absolutely kills it. I've been trying to learn it for like the last 8 weeks. I'm nearly there, man.
I've been meaning Why Stevie Ray Vaughan? Because that's the cover, isn't it? Of who did the original?
Yeah, yeah. Jimi Hendrix.
Yeah, exactly. So
I'm just typing in Stevie Ray Vaughan release date. Because I was just saying to Talal, Jimmy plays Little Wing, like obviously he played it a squillion, million, billion, trillion times.
Yeah.
Stevie Ray Vaughan was a guitarist in like the South, playing like, you know, shit bars and stuff like that. And his brother was known as the sickest guitarist in the South.
Yeah.
But then Stevie Ray Vaughan obviously like overtook that and became massive.
When was this? In the 60s? The 60s, 70s?
No, like his version was released in 68.
Okay.
Wow.
Jimi Hendrix is already dead. You know what I mean? And Jimi Hendrix plays the guitar, plays the intro and plays like the rhythm throughout it, but also he sings it.
Jimmy was dead by 68?
Yeah. Well, like, we can Google that as well.
Wow. Yeah, I don't know. I have no idea.
Imagine he died so early.
He died in the, what's it called? The 27 Club, no?
In a puddle of his own puke. 1970, he died in 18th September 1970 in Notting Hill, London.
When did this SRAV come out? Stevie Ray Vaughan come out?
I have no idea.
69, I said, no? 68.
Okay, so just before, basically. But anyway, yeah, so.
Just before.
What drew you
sings,
to that?
Jimmy sings the verses. Stevie Ray plays the intro on the guitar and plays all of the verses as well.
Yeah.
But he kind of plays it. And because of that, I just find out the amount of soul and stuff in the way he plays it. And he's a blues guitarist.
Yeah.
Jimmy's like more of like, well, Jimmy could do everything but like rock or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
But this is like proper, proper bluesy. Fucking brilliant. Fucking brilliant.
Talal, I want to know your reaction to it.
Do you think there is an element of a white man playing black man's music? Capitalizing on it.
Well, yeah, but in
hashtag Black Lives Matter,
like it definitely did with Elvis and shit. But you know what happened with like Led Zeppelin, like that era there, 60s, 70s, kind of for England was much bigger than America.
No, I'm saying
Beatles, Rolling Stones, Led Zeppelin,
playing a Jimi Hendrix song. But I'm kind of joking. No,
but he's American as well. But I'm saying British people, like Led Zeppelin. Mm. They were shit in England. They weren't, you know, they're one of the biggest groups of all time. They didn't have much of a fanfare in England whatsoever. They go to America, just like the Rolling Stones and shit did, started singing blues and stuff to these guys. These guys are like, what the fuck? These white boys can fucking do this. Like some of them, like Led Zeppelin, they can do this. And they took blues and all that kind of shit and absolutely killed it and had like number one singles in America and stuff. When they came back to England, everyone was like, what the fuck, Led Zeppelin? But when they were in England, it was like, what the fuck are they doing?
Yeah.
But loads of people are pissed off with them for going over there. Yeah. And stealing
But the thing is, from what I've seen of those artists, from the Beatles, Rolling Stones, fucking even Elvis, I've seen interviews with those people and they're like, yeah, Chuck Berry.
They
don't say they stole it. They said, look,
Chuck Berry and those kind of guys, like Howling Wolf, Chuck Berry, all those guys, they were quite minor.
It was
America. They were like big in Tennessee or whatever.
Yeah.
But when Led Zeppelin made blues massive,
they made
all these people
made
blues massive. Yeah. They were like, well, some of this fucking money. This, what the fuck's going on? These English kids with long hair
have
come over here to Tennessee, played in like the Southern Fried Chicken joints. And fucking gone back to around the world and become global superstars.
But also,
not Stevie Ray. Stevie Ray was from there.
They call that the British invasion, right?
Yeah.
Something like that.
But is it not true? The British, the Led Zeppelins, the, what's his name? The guy who bit a bat off his head, the bat Ozzy. Guy. What's his fucking name?
Ozzy Osbourne,
all them boys. They took those blues and they developed it, but they created a whole next thing as well. Out of that.
Well, not really next thing. The blues is blues, isn't it?
Yeah.
But let's say I know what Maddie's saying. What Maddie's saying is
you know
Rolling
what I'm
Stones
saying?
Like, weren't just a blues band. Like they did.
Yeah.
They Yeah, I they made their name. They used,
and obviously
they used blues and music to make their name in America, but then used that as a launching pad to then boost their career and pay their own music.
I agree with you. Yeah.
And it also was a matter of a big distinction that in the UK, in Europe, and in America, when it was black music and black musicians doing it, it wasn't breaking the charts. But once the white face were doing it, even though they had good intentions initially, and they were like, yeah, these are my inspirations, and we're just doing, you know, following on from them. But the media and everyone, they were like, look at these boys, and they put them as the king of rock and roll, you know what I mean? Yeah, Elvis, exactly. And all that, when they, the it had been done before, you know? But that's what kind of...
All
and
I
it's,
was
not necessarily, saying, it's not necessarily the artist's fault. That's all I'm saying.
But you... Like, initially. That wasn't what my initial point... My you know, you're talking about point. White people who made their fortune playing what is known as black music. I'm talking about a guy covering a song by a black artist. But I was kind of being cheeky. I was being silly. That's quite a common thing. If someone is a guitar musician...
Genius.
If someone is a musician who isn't a pop singer, they're literally just a guitarist. You've got like Stevie Ray Vaughan and then like... Who are these other guys that they've managed to like sell out? There are these like artists. I can't
Eric
think of
Clapton,
their names right now. Not even Eric Clapton sings. I'm talking about guys who literally just play guitar and they have a band with them, but then there's no singing and they'll sell out the O2.
I know.
Like, they have these huge fucking audiences. And like, I don't see the appeal. I'm like, I want to go see a band that sings songs, but like these guys just make guitar pieces. And
they're covering old songs as well. Often, it's like, you know, why would I pay to see them? Pieces,
but they're like more akin to like, you know, classical music or like a composer who writes musical pieces and like performs them. And Stevie Ray Vaughan is one of the greats. And there was another at the time, a British guy actually. He's from a council estate just outside of London, I think. His name is Davy Graham. You might want to look him up, theme. Davy Graham. He actually played. Right. He does this. He's amazing. Fucking plays Spanish guitar, but not Spanish style, but like, you know, the finger picky guitar stuff. And he did that cover of the Mustafa song that I played at bloody Dad's funeral.
Mustafa, yeah, Mustafa.
It was an amazing cover of it. But like, there's some English guy in the 60s playing Mustafa to English audiences, and. He's incredible and
one of the most influential figures in the 1960s in British folk revival.
Davy Graham,
yeah,
amazing guitarist. You might want to look him up if you're playing guitar and you're looking for inspiration. And there's a more
he inspired Jimmy Page. Jimmy Page is a guitarist from Led Zeppelin.
Uh huh.
There's a
Paul
more,
Simon.
More modern guy.
Was Led Zeppelin had the one armed drummer?
No, that was the drummer from Def Leppard.
Def Leppard. That was a Def Leppard. Sorry.
The drummer from Def Leppard only had one arm. The drummer from Def Leppard only had one arm. The drummer from Def Leppard only had one arm. The drummer from Def Leppard only had one. That's the only reason why I know that fact is because of that.
It's
a Bloodhound Gang.
What's that, Wayne's World?
No, it's a Bloodhound Gang song. It's the ending of
Bloodhound
Gang. He just says that 10 times.
And
the other guy,
baby,
I want to let you know about
the mammals.
There's a more modern guitarist, jazz guitarist called John Scofield. And he does a cover of Shania.
I got a couple of records of his.
No way.
I think Scofield, because I get mixed up with the other
Not
Scofield.
Not Philip Scofield.
Philip, yeah, I got mixed up with him, but I think I've seen, some Scofield.
He does a cover of Shania Twain's You're Still the One. You're still the one I run.
Oh, dude. What? In the 90s?
This is more recent. I'm
How
saying.
Old is...
This guy's more recent.
Okay, maybe
John Scofield.
He's an old guy.
British sprint canoeist.
He's an old guy.
So not from the 60s.
Scofield
not from the
60s, is 70s. S-C-O. There's no H in the Scofield.
And
that song, You're Still the One by John Scofield, brings me to fucking tears almost every time I hear it. It's so beautiful.
Wow.
It's better than the original song. It's fucking gorgeous. He plays it. It's so simple. It's just a bass and organ.
Not a fan of the original song. I'm glad.
So Talal, you're trying to tell us now that you cry to
7-year-old
I suggested that song for today's podcast.
Let's see if we can make him cry now.
What's her
You're
fucking name?
It is
what's the name of the Shania Twain? So a Shania Twain song makes you cry, Talal.
It's a beautiful song. And you know what? You guys are so fucking hardcore and hip hop and like, yeah, you're fucking
we're so cool
hip hop dudes. But I,
what was the song theme just fucking recommended now? Was that a super hardcore hip hop tune? Yeah. All right.
But I've learned in the last few years to not be so snobby about pop music. Like pop music.
No, of course. I'm only kidding.
Good.
I have some guilty pleasures, that's for sure.
Yeah, but it's not just about guilty
Rocket
pleasures.
Man. I have Rocket Man by Eric Clapton. That's pop music, man.
It's a big tune. Talal, no, we're not going to listen to it like that, Talal. You're the fucking... No, Talal, stop. Please stop. Talal, you of all people, as the producer of this podcast, should know not to play songs over the mic like that. You should have sent me this earlier, and I would have played it. So I'm sorry, guys. I'm not showing Talal any love from this one. Stop it. We're going to move on to the next tune now. Talal knows that's
it's
a faux
brilliant
part.
That you're so fuming. Right. It's just
that's
it's
a faux part. It's
okay.
You can't be doing
it's brilliant
that.
Viewing.
It's fine. Talal's supposed to be the producer. I love that song so much. I wish I suggested it to you, and I regret the song I did send you. Shall I introduce my song?
Well, no. So Talal, we'll have you on in the future, and you can play that song as well. But wait, before you introduce your song, Talal.
And that was a lovely song theme. Really nice. And
we should end. Maddie, you should end the podcast on that song.
No. Check this out. I almost forgot. I'm going to. Guys, this isn't a Arms House to Your Mom's House t-shirt, but it's a Tarbush Records t-shirt, which is me and my man Frez. We have a record label.
Presidente.
We have a logo. That's it there. Can you see that? That's a large t-shirt there. Yeah? Anyone watching now, if you're watching...
$49.99, motherfuckers!
No, Black Friday! No!
$39.99!
If you're listening to this anywhere,
yeah,
go to our YouTube channel. It's called Arms House to Your Mom's House. If you leave a comment on this episode, episode 4, if you leave a comment on our YouTube video for episode 4 of Arms House to Your Mom's House,
I will give you a nosh.
or leave a review on Apple Podcasts and quote episode 4 in the review.
No, this is just for YouTube. If you leave a comment on YouTube, I'm going to pick one at random and I'm going to send you a t-shirt for free, okay? So leave a comment on the YouTube channel.
Guys, he won't even give me Maddie one of those t-shirts, so that is a fucking good deal, man.
So I'm just saying, if you leave a comment on this video right here, just saying whatever, or leave an emoji, you don't even have to say anything, but if you leave a comment, I will pick one at random and I will send you a t-shirt.
I'll burp into that t-shirt for you.
I'm not going to burp into nothing.
If you leave two comments, we'll try and get African Bambar to give you a hand job. If you leave two comments.
All right, now,
just
Talal.
Just a quick HJ.
Talal, okay, so introduce your song.
I was... Maddie, I was caught off guard when you asked me to suggest a song. I don't regret the band I suggested. I regret the song choice because it's their most obvious song.
It's an obvious song.
I know every song of this band's back catalogue and I fucking love them. And but I chose their most obvious
Counting
song.
Crows.
And it's the song that everyone knows and I wish I picked a bit more of a niche one. However, I also was under the impression that you guys were only picking hip hop songs, and I thought I would
Metallica.
I would pick this as a way of kind of because me and Amber are brothers, yeah, but we're very different, and whilst also being very similar, but we're very different in a lot of ways, and so I thought I'd pick something that's like as far away from hip hop as possible, but then fucking Theme came in and played a blues song, so like it's. Kind of ruined.
But also,
I'm learning that song.
This song as well. Also, this song, Talal, is not only is it a legendary song, but there is links to hip hop with this song as well, man.
Yeah.
As far as you think is far removed from hip hop, and it is. But if you chat to any of the members of this band, they will tell you hip hop members.
I'll find a link somewhere.
The song there is because the song I was kind of thinking, I should have picked this one. Their cover of Wu-Tang's Shame on a N-Word. What's the
shame on her? If you could get shame on her,
that's the old dirty bastard.
Yeah, old DB.
No. One of his singles. Method Man. Yeah, he's in the Wu Tang, but it's his song.
Isn't it a Wu Tang
song? No, it's his song. It's a Wu Tang affiliated ODB. Song, but it's ODB
Man,
song.
Method Man guests features on it, I guess.
Yeah.
One, two, three. Well, yeah, System. There was an. I remember. So this song is Chop Suey by System of a Down. I remember when I was a teenager, there was like, I don't know, with Q magazine or Kerrang magazine, there was a CD
Kerrang.
Stuck to the front cover of it.
Sorry. Yeah, go on.
There was a CD, a compilation of rock bands doing covers of hip hop songs, and System covered Shame on Her. And they said the N-word.
Oh wow! Okay, yeah, but they're Armenian, right?
They're Armenian.
Or they're so like
play the track, and then black, I'll tell you about, but they're all not about white. System. They are fucking amazing.
Should we let's listen to a one little
of
bit
the,
of
the... one of the only heavy metal bands I like, because I'm not a heavy metal head, but I was a rock kid. Go on, play it. I have so much.
Wait. Before I play it, Themos, are you wearing a onesie right now? What is
that? Yeah, he said. It's a
Primark onesie.
Have you seen the Primark
Chicago Bulls?
It's not a onesie. Massive. It's just a massive
jumper. It's not a onesie.
It's like a skirt. It's like a skirt.
It's just a big ass.
You see the Greg's line.
It's got a hood with the Bulls. Mate, the Greg's basketball kit.
The Greg's line in Primark. I want to get.
No one's buying it. No,
everyone in Brighton is buying it. Everyone in Brighton.
They got full Greg's basketball kit, Maddie, in there.
I don't give a shit about stuff like that.
A Primark Greg's event in Brighton, in the street. I'm telling you, the Greg's range is...
They know their audience.
All of my Brighton friends all own every Greg's item from Primark. And guess who performed in the street in Brighton wearing Greg's clothes? Khalees. They flew Khalees from America to Brighton.
I hate you so much right
they
now.
They put her in the fucking Greg's jogging so suit. Right, and she's saying, I hate you so much right now. And
it's money, man.
Did she sing? Did she sing, my Cornish pasties bring the boys to the yard? And they're like, it's better than yours. And you're like, it's better than yours. Why I man, it's better than
play
yours.
My song,
no,
play
big up Khalees.
Play my song. Why I man?
Play,
they don't say why I man in Cornwall.
It's the Newcastle.
Listen to those drums. Listen to those drums. In my ear holes. Oh my god, I haven't listened to that song in so long, and it fucking slaps, man.
To the people just watch, to the people just listening now, you missed out, because if you watch us on YouTube, you'll see Talal head banging his ass after that
tune. Oh my god, that song.
Even I got my hair out.
You might like that song's a bit overplayed or whatever, but if you don't listen to that song for a while and then you listen to it again, you're like,
look at
what a tune. So that song, I think, came out that song was from
if you don't fucking listen to that tune once in a while, fuck me. He's like rocking in his chair.
There's a few things I want to say.
You've seen them live, right? You've seen
them live.
Didn't you like catch the
they played so hard that the guitarist's trousers and pants fell down. And then he was like, and he his guitar was covering his genitals. But then when he was like carried on playing till the end of the song, and then when he bent down to pick up his trousers, everyone saw his dick and balls. It was really funny.
So Talal, describe his dick and balls.
They were surprising. The dick was tiny, but the balls were huge. But and he had massive bush of pubes. And I was very disappointed.
They're Armenian and fucking Turkish. So
the band are very anti-establishment and anarchic, and like very into their activism. But then
I get a lot of Rage Against the Machine vibes.
Yeah,
not the same. No, they're not in the terms same of, at all.
Yeah, absolutely.
But vibes.
In terms of their anti-politics, I mean, their political output, indeed, 100% Rage.
But they're not as cool as
they're much
as
cooler. And so like after, but I was really let down after cooler. The when I was a teenager. I used to hang around. I used to go to a lot of rock gigs, and then afterwards I'd hang around in the alleyway behind the venue to meet them as they're coming out and stuff, and get them to sign my shoe. I had this Vans shoe
that was
covered in signatures.
What did his balls taste like?
Hey, yeah, son of a bitch. But I was really disappointed to see them getting McDonald's. They got McDonald's. The bassist like showed up with loads of McDonald's, and I was like, "You assholes! Get like a kebab."
Oh, they didn't do a McDonald's advert.
No, they like were eating McDonald's after the gig.
Thank God for that.
What, you wanted them to get a Greggs?
Something. They're so political.
This came from Greggs.
Okay, I just want to get this out. Okay, look, there's a couple things about this. Amazing song, amazing band. Honestly, like I said, I'm not a heavy metal guy, but these guys, like, this isn't even about the band. I don't even want to talk about the band. I want to talk about why I'm picking them. But I will just say, because they're Armenian Americans, they're very like loyal to their roots, and they use in all of their songs, they use the Middle Eastern scales in their. So that's why I think I clung to them as like the only heavy metal band I ever really loved. Because it sounds so different and unique. Because the scales and the notes they play are from the Middle Eastern scales, which
the Oriental
obviously
scale, they call it.
Is obviously resonates with me.
Orient,
obviously resonates with me, but because I'm an Arab, forgive me.
Mm.
What are they called again?
System of a Down.
System.
I used to call them
System of a Down.
I used to call them Syndrome of a Down.
There used to be a band called Syndrome back in the day.
Yeah.
Anyway.
And
Akit's going to definitely leave,
Akit,
man.
I'm sorry, Akit.
Basically, very Akit. The lyrics are very politically motivated, very interesting. Lots of fucking great anti-establishment, anti-governmental statements and fucking beautiful music, and they are
just great music.
They are just great,
really cool.
I wish I picked maybe a more niche song, but whatever.
Yeah,
I'm not gonna. So and then okay, so the main reason is I picked this. I'm Maddie's brother. We also have an older sister, and I picked this to kind of highlight how different us three are. It's quite amazing how growing up we all had completely different paths in terms of our musical taste, but also in terms of our social circles.
But we also overlap. There's overlapping, but there is a definite distinct.
Shahla was all about soul and funk and shit. And Maddie
jazz.
Was like hip hop. Yeah, he is hip hop. And then I was like all about rock and guitar and grunge music and
you were a little
like
pussy.
Shitty fucking rock bands. And
I'm just kidding.
Learning to play guitar and stuff like that. And I used to have bleached, frosted tips. I used to have long bleached hair.
Like
and,
Green Day.
And I used to wear skater clothes and shit. Like, I was proper grunge.
But Talal,
and I used to have drum kit. And I still 14. Have a drum kit in the garage. And my mates would come around.
Yeah,
we'd jam
I
out
it.
In the garage and shit. Yeah, Maddie.
I was into Nirvana. I was in 93. I was
and Shahla loved Nirvana. Shahla got me into Nirvana and Radiohead. Like Radiohead are the
I remember,
greatest band in the world.
I remember we were in Syria on holiday, and we were in a hotel, and me and Shahla were in the hotel room looking through the channels, and MTV came on. No, it can't have been MTV. It would have been another channel, because in Syria they didn't have any American influence at all. It was all Japanese or something else, and or like Eastern European there was an Eastern European music channel and they said Kurt Cobain died. Like, you know, they announced it. And I was there with Shala, and Shala started bursting into tears.
Oh, no.
Man. She started crying in front of me, man.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember. And I remember.
His wife.
Well, that's the conspiracy theory. That's the Maddie conspiracy. Maddie loves the conspiracy.
One episode, yeah, you want? I want you to research that conspiracy and do that for your conspiracy.
I think that will be a good one. But there's been documentaries on it and everything. But yeah, you know, the official consensus is he blew his own brains out with a shotgun.
I was big into the rock stuff, and so it was. It's quite cool having such a so much diversity within one household growing up. I thought that was just like a nice thing,
and
it
did create some Arabic.
Our parents all loved Arabic music, so like, even mum and dad like different types of Arabic music. Mum likes the poppy Arabic shit music, and dad liked the more classic.
He'd like,
you know, classically composed Arabic music.
And dad loved Madonna
and
as well.
Did cause a bit of, there was a bit of tension in the house. Like, Maddie used to beat the shit out of me and like bully me with his mates and shit, because they were all such badass hip-hop dudes, graff heads, and they'd come home from a mission or buzzed out on
you were just the easy
Ease
target
and Whiz, and so they would kick my head
target,
in.
Bro.
Ease and Whiz.
You were just the easy target, brother.
So
I'm sorry.
And then the second thing I want to say is, I was very grateful for discovering this band. And it was that song that made me notice them, because that was such a big hit. But then I went and bought their first album, which this is from their second album. Listen to
what year did
that
come out?
That song is from around 2002, because I saw them live in 2003. And it was a Toxicity tour. It was the tour of this album. So it was probably the year before.
But their first album came out in 2000?
Their first album was probably from 99 or something. And it's a self-titled album. And it is... it is probably better than Toxicity. And it's got one of my favorite songs of all time is called Soil, and it's a System of a Down track. But anyway, my point is, let me just finish ranting because this is getting really boring.
Many points.
Hurry up.
I'm very grateful for this band because I was like, 15? And all the music I liked was like rocky, grungy shit, but they were always singing about, you know, really fucking boring, love and fucking skating or whatever the fuck, fucking cheesy bullshit that didn't matter. Just like having a good time. Somebody once told me the world was breaking up. And System of a Down was the first time I listened to music that had serious subject matter. Like, this song is about suicide and shit. And like other songs were talking about how governments sell bombs to other countries to bomb other countries, like, and you know, their songs had important fucking, and a lot like hip-hop music, what you guys listen to is talking about important subjects and like inequality in society and class and race
KRS-One.
And war and hate and love, and like I was like, my mind was just like, oh, songs don't have to be about asking a girl out to prom. A song can be about important shit. Yeah. And it just blew my fucking mind, and it changed my perspective on music, because also it was the first metal band that I was like, this shit is amazing. It's not just noise. It's actually beautiful. And I'm just forever grateful and will always love that band to the bottom of my heart. Every musician in that band is at the top of their class. The drummer is one of the best drummers ever lived on this planet.
What's his name?
Fuck knows. And the singer is incredible. Yeah. And it's just, they're just mind blowing.
Ertegun.
I'm Googling
Ertegun.
Them,
I bet it's Ertegun.
Tankian is the singer.
Oh, there we go.
The drummer.
But Talal, it's mad that you say that. You just reminded me, when I was listening to hip hop, I was like, all hip hop has to be about some sort of social thing going on.
Oh, yeah.
You know, that's what all hip hop was about. It? You know? But then I heard, you know, I heard someone like Cool Keith, who was just rapping, just like stream of consciousness, talking about aliens and talking about, I'm like a, like from, I'm rapping from the perspective of like a transvestite, you know what I mean? Or whatever. You know, he was like just MF like Doom rapping and... about all, Yeah, and then I was like, oh shit, so you don't just have to rap about being a bad man or, yeah, you know, fuck
the government.
It's
kind of the opposite, isn't
you
it?
Know, type of thing. I was like, oh, okay, you can literally rap about anything. Him and like Pharaoh Munch, their concepts were incredible, man. And that kind of, yeah, I was like, oh shit, oh right, okay, you know? That's
I had
deep,
the reverse Talal, experience.
Yeah, but System of a Down, definitely, if you haven't heard about him, you should definitely check that.
Profound
shit.
Profound stuff. And I'm sorry for taking
theme,
up so
what's
much
your
air
thoughts?
Time.
What's your theme? What's
I
your...
thinking I had I never had that. I had a massive sort of season of like Pearl Jam, Nirvana, Metallica, all of those kind of guys. Rage Against the Machine.
Jeremy Spoken.
Yeah, I was massively into that shit.
I never
into hip hop as well. Yeah. But that's the fact. I was chatting to my friend about that. I never got into Pearl Jam until like last year. But because I was always like, no, Nirvana shits on Pearl Jam. Nirvana shits on Pearl Jam. I was into Guns N' Roses, Metallica.
Guns N' Roses straight
Nirvana,
up.
Nirvana, really. Nirvana, like, massively. But I always loved tracks of Metallica always hip hop.
I always loved the, when I was getting into hip hop, and I loved Guns N' Roses, but then that tune they did for Terminator 2, you could be mine, you could be mine. You know, you could be mine, yeah? And he's wearing the NWA.
You
no, but wait. Yeah, in the video, Axl Rose is wearing the NWA on his cap. He's wearing an NWA cap.
No way.
And I remember watching that going, yo, Axl is down, man. He knows the fucking coup, man. He's down with
it
NWA.
Was only
he turned
money,
out to
man.
Be a
only
massive cunt.
Like,
that guy.
Yes!
Oh, yeah, massive cunt.
Yeah, he turned out to be, yeah. But at the time, but I remember seeing that video and he had the NWA cap on. I was like, I need that fucking cap, man. I never got it, but I'm just saying. I used to love that. But okay, let's go to themes next song. This is a underground UK hip hop tune. All right. I'm in particular
because I've never done that. We've not done that on the podcast yet.
Yo. Theme is a established UK MC. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, thank you.
He's a bad man.
I've got my stripes and everything.
He brushes shoulders with the elite UK.
I really struggle with that genre, and I don't know why.
Why?
I think it's just conditioning.
This is newer than
that. No. Wait. Personally, I hate the term UK hip hop. I hate that term. Hip hop is hip hop.
Hip hop is hip hop. You know what I'm saying?
I don't care if it's
from. I knew you were going to say that.
I don't care if it's from Germany, from UK, from America. I don't give a fuck where it's from. If it's hip hop, it's hip hop.
You do.
No,
it's African Bambaataa.
What do you mean I do? What?
Because like you won't sit and I know what you're going to say. Yeah, I do. But you won't like sit and just for recreation just listen to some German hip hop.
Apart from French hip hop,
I do it all
French
the time. Talal, I do it
hands
all
down is
the
some
time.
Of the sickest shit that come in the '90s in Paris. I am lunatic.
French,
all
obviously.
Of these fucking guys.
Mafia Confrères
sont treize.
Yeah, I'm a francophile, yeah, so of course French hip hop has been a big thing. But Talal, man, I listen to a shit ton. If I can't understand the language, then yeah, okay, I'm not big on the rappers, but the beat,
I'll take the beat.
The beat.
Take the beat.
Man, I listen to
sell it darkness.
Yo, guys, this is a gem right now. One of my favorite beat makers, full stop, is a German beat maker. His name is Hulk Hoden. Look him up, man. And Hulk Hoden, you know what that means in German?
What?
Hoden means balls. Yeah. Hulk means big. Yeah. It's big balls. Like big balls. Yeah. That's I didn't great. Know that when I first knew. I went into a record shop in Germany and I was like, yo, God, I need some beats from Hulk Hoden. He was like, and he started cracking up. I was like, what are you laughing? He was like, Hulk Hoden means big balls. And I was like, well, there's a producer called Hulk Hoden. He was like, I never heard of him. That's how I learned what Hulk Hoden means. But anyway, respect Hulk Hoden. But let's listen to this track. From Theme. It's by Melanin 9 or M9.
Oh shit.
Featuring Triple Darkness.
Sell it darkness.
It's called Heart. It's called Heartless Island. I want to hear Talal's reaction.
Produced by Jest.
But also, Talal, it's produced by Jest, for real.
Is it Jest the rapper? Yeah.
I didn't know that. Jest is a rapper, but he produces as well, man.
Stay in your lane,
but Talal, I want to hear Talal. I want to hear Talal's reaction. But also, Talal, I want you to realize that Melanin 9, couple of the heads featured in this track, they're going to be listening right now.
Give
as well,
a fuck. Talal. Play the track.
I'm just saying.
Whack!
What's this? The YouTube intro?
Oh, is this? Okay, sorry. Yeah, it's going to drop in now. There we go.
His voice.
Raise my glass then to bastard fatherless men. Depart to Shem, use scalpels to carve gems, form planets. Pick locks, the doors banish. Shape shift in the state, bricks from wars packaged. Cause madness in the soundless dawn. Body bags wrapped to council porn. Put my trust in the powerful force. My partner's been cutting fathom in court. Forced to divorce the street character. Talking and all his barriers, no enforcements, endorse war strips, course shifting and caution. Lips talk to kick doors for shitty portions, orbiting your perimeter. A master of the obvious ligature, cross another acquiescent picture. Compose fragments, chose some ambient mixtures.
Ambient mixture,
pose with biscuits.
Frozen Arabic.
The chromosomes missed it. Frames tailored to fit the bones of
a Arabic. Quick Arabic.
One's bowels to feed your vowels through syringes. Throw idols holistic. Tile off his hinges where the soul resides in the distance. We shine like distant stars on the horizon. Craft this art from the path of Orion.
Very nice, really nice.
On the
tart
of the island. Distant stars on the horizon. Yo,
that's good,
man.
Yeah, I wasn't expecting that. That's really nice.
Shapeshift into state bricks where roars package. Cause madness in the soundless storm. Body bags wrapped in council porn. Put my trust in the powerful force. My punishment couldn't fathom in court. Forced to divorce the street character. You talk into lawless barrister. Enforcements endorse war strips. Cold shifting the caution. Lips sought to kick doors for shitty portions. Orbit in your perimeter. A master of the obvious ligature. Craft another... Fucking, I can't even read that.
Easy.
Frozen Arabics pose with biscuits. Other colder than cult scripture.
Wait. Theme. Hold on. Theme, hold on. Talal, in hip-hop lexicon, when someone calls something a biscuit, do you know what a biscuit is?
Yeah.
What?
It's when you, when you take, you know, like some chocolate. You take some chopped
mackerel. What's a biscuit?
It's like chopped mackerel in a salad. Like you do a tuna niçoise salad, but you use mackerel instead of tuna.
Why is that a biscuit?
It's just like taste bomb, isn't it?
Oh, but Maddie, play the
book. Biscuit is like a wad of cash. No, it's hash. It's hash. Hashish.
No, it's a gun.
Flingering a clip.
It's a gun.
Oh, right. It's a gun.
Listen, how is that Themos, biscuit? I can't. I don't know why.
You can't because it's on a YouTube thing.
No, it's not on a YouTube. I've got here on this app. I can literally just start it and stop it. I can't skip it.
The hook is like mad good for doing it live. Man, that's a fucking track.
It's a good track.
You know what I mean? Produced by Jeff.
That's just
Cyrus Malachi and M9.
Really fantastic. Like it really jumped, you know?
But Talal, it's a real simplistic beat. It's not like some overly musical thing.
It's not just simplistic because the comes in at the nicest moment. It's not just like a 4-4. It's like fucking great sampling there.
Ultimately,
M9 for me, like top five lyricist.
But I'm not dissing something when I say something is simplistic. I think the ultimate goal is to find the most simplistic route to the goal. You know what I mean? If you can reach the goal in the most simplistic pathway, that's the genius. You know what I mean? It's not like trying to add all this shit and make something incredible, which can happen.
Trying too hard, yeah.
That's what I'm saying. When I hear this beat, it's a simple beat, but you don't get bored of it. You can hear
the rapper's great.
Over.
What's his name?
The lyrics.
Melanin.
M9.
He does that real, real pure kind of Hip hop, man.
How old is that track?
Fucking brilliant.
Ultra lyrical.
You don't hear that kind of shit from British rappers. How old is that track?
It's not that old. I don't know, but
his album was like critically acclaimed when it came out.
Yeah,
with that track on it.
But it was a massive
piece of work. There's a tune called "The Seventh Blues,"
yeah,
which is like has like I think it's like 8 minutes long. Has a mad, incredible musical intro and shit. I've got tracks with him. I've done tracks with him on,
yeah,
which have come out on "Toys Got Smoke," made by Beach Butcher.
You know who irks me? Skinny Man. I know you guys love Skinny Man, but I can't stand Skinny Man.
Why?
He's too angry.
Nah.
He's too angry and he's whiny. He's like to a point where he's whiny. And
what have you heard from Skinny Man? What have you actually heard? You ain't heard shit.
We're going to say smoking ban. Can't smoke, he's a smoking ban. Yeah. Ain't going to come at me smoking ban.
What are you going to do?
Smoking ban. Hey, everybody smoking ban. What are we going to do today? Smoking ban.
Can't talk to me with a smoking ban.
Everybody play with the smoking ban. I'm like, shut up.
Angry. That was joke.
That was like a novelty track. I know.
Novelty, gimmicky song. He's got a classic album. Talal, listen.
He irks me. I find him irritating. He's very skinny and he's angry. And like, he's just like...
he's very skinny.
And it's like, I feel like I could take him, you know?
Talal, listen, I tell you what irks me from UK hip hop in general.
Yeah.
What used to irk me was that I used to call it chip on the shoulder rap. That's what I used to call it. Chip on the shoulder rap.
Where they're just like pissed off with everything.
Everyone's fucking me up and everything's fucked up and everything's fucked up. And like everything they're rapping about, ultimate respect to Task Force, but they fell down that rabbit hole with the, you know, the Junkyard and a couple big, you know, of course, I'm not disrespecting them, legendary dudes, of course, but they kind of fell down that chip on the shoulder rap. Like every song is about how they're getting screwed over somehow, you know? But they also obviously Task Force legends. They did many different types of songs. You
it's
know what
weird
I mean?
But I'm just saying, there's a fine line. Like there's, you want to make a point and you want to be political, but then, yeah, you're also that you can just sound kind of like bitter and annoyed and angry.
But they were rapping about what they saw. They grew up in Finsbury, Parker State.
You can't take that away
from
them.
A dog shit place in like the '80s and nineties. Do you know what I mean?
Exactly.
Like mad dog shit.
And again, I don't want to put that as a disrespect, but I used to call it chip on the shoulder.
Sounds like
rap.
A disrespect. To me, man. I mean, I think the podcast's over, man. You know?
No, I think it was more of a matter of like kind of there was only so much of it I could take to a certain degree. Mm. You know what
MFTC.
I mean? It's necessary.
MFTC.
It's needed. Some of my favorite hip hop songs in general, whether it's UK, US hip hop, whatever hip hop is a song that has a meaning. It has a anarchist kind of vibe or not anarchist.
Activist.
Fuck the government.
Activist,
that's the one I'm trying to think, like an activist sort of vibe. Yeah, I like that.
Have we got any more songs?
No, that's it. But I think we're going to call it a day right now, man. But you know, let's just round this down right now.
Let me just say,
before we move on, big up Melanie.
I do need to go and get a beer. Salute. Big up M9 every time.
Salute
every
all them boys. God
damn time.
Who was the dude who passed away? The producer, Seventh Dan.
Seventh Dan. Man, Salute. He sent me some beats as well, man. Salute. I was always thinking, shall I do something on one of those beats? But I don't have the stems. I've only got the actual MP, whatever it is.
Well,
that
we should talk about this in private, but I think you definitely should, man.
And I've had some heavy bars for that, man.
I bet.
Because he was killing it at the time. Killing it.
We need to get a project, man, out with theme, with production from IMS. Big up Ill Move Sporadic. He's another guy who gave us some nice feedback from there.
There's two of them.
I'll get a beat on there, you know what I mean? We'll release a little EP, man. That'll be sick.
We've got Farmer G giving me some
beats.
Yeah,
Farmer
G
is killing it.
We'll get some other peeps. You, IMS.
Yeah.
I've got two tracks coming with IMS on a vinyl.
Whatever happened to
Pit
Man?
We'll have to talk about that. To who?
God knows what happened to Pitman. Andy, did you ever hear about Pitman? He's like from the West Country. I don't know where the fuck he's from. Cornwall. I don't know where the fuck. Pitman. But he's from out in the country somewhere. And he used to do covers of famous hip hop songs. Like, for example, He did. He did Pitman. He did a cover of 50 Cent in the club. Buddy with a bud, we know what. You know that In the Club song, yeah?
Yeah.
But he did one called In the Pub. I'll be in the pub.
I saw that MC Pitman. Pit in, he's down the pit, the Yorkshire mines.
Yeah, the Yorkshire. He was down in Yorkshire. God knows what happened to him. But he was another one of those gimmicky kind of rappers. But you could tell that he loved the culture. Like he wasn't just some dude coming in trying to like spoof these songs. Like he was a proper hip hop head. But he was mad gimmicky. So Talal, God knows what happened to him. Maybe we'll look out for that and find out.
So if we're rounding up this podcast here, we've basically talked about nothing apart from nearly getting nicked a couple of times.
Mm.
African Bambaataa's Hand Shandies.
Yeah.
And a couple of our tracks.
Yeah.
And that's it.
What else do you want?
Well, we had loads of we haven't talked about any
shit. I spoke about how I met KRS-One the other day. I saw him.
Yeah, that's true.
He did. Listen,
I was thinking about something.
Yeah, Talal said. Yeah, go on.
When you were talking to Talal about one of your friend's girlfriend at the time or something like that. I've always looked back on that shit and thought, isn't that weird when someone joined, you know, you've got a crew of mates growing up.
Yeah.
One of them gets a girlfriend and she's never in the crew or she infiltrates the crew.
Yeah.
And then she's in the crew. Yeah. And everyone, and you don't know for shit. You have to get used to her and get to know her and build up her. And then your friend stops going out with her. Bam, she's out the crew.
Yeah.
You never see her again. She's always considered. If you saw her like in fucking Sainsbury's in 4 years, you'd be like, oh, I remember when she came. She might have gone on holiday with you or something like that.
We have one of those in my crew.
Everyone's got
in my crew. There was a girl who had a boyfriend, and he infiltrated the crew and became like every occasion we were together, he was around. Yeah, and then they broke up. And not only they broke up, he did something terrible. Like he was a cunt.
And he was your mate, or no?
No, she was our mate.
She was their mate.
Couple of my mates, especially one of them, kept kind of seeing him on the side because they were like so close.
Yeah.
And he's they would cool like guy. Meet he's up nice play guy. Board games and shit. And he was like, never tell her that I saw him. Like I'd be like, what did he get up to this weekend? Like, oh yeah, I hung out with this guy and blah blah blah. Because you can't tell her that I was like, don't worry, I won't tell her. But then the more and more I heard about what he did that made her break up with him. I was like, shit, I got to tell her because this guy's an absolute asshole. Like, what the fuck are you doing hanging out with this guy? He betrayed our friend.
Yeah.
And eventually, so though.
You were keeping it 100 with your mate.
Eventually, though, my mate kind of, we all kind of learnt together a bit more about what this guy did. And eventually, it just put him off hanging out with him anymore. And he's like, you know what?
Yeah,
I'm not gonna hang out with you anymore. But for ages, for like a year or two, he was like hanging out with this guy on the sly, on the side. It was like a secret little.
See what I mean? A year or two. Yeah. You can be like reminiscing about. Do you remember when we was on holiday? It was me. You know what I mean, Dave? It was Lauren. Oh shit! Do you remember Lauren? Like she was in the crew for like 3 years.
Yeah.
4 years we used to party at her house, we used to do this, we used to do that, we used to fuck her house up. Now she's just completely boyed off.
Yeah,
but she was like, you saw her every day.
It happens, man. It
happens in every single crew. I think it's a fucking madness.
It happens, madness. Man.
And now people are married. You're like, oh, do you remember that expert Tatiana you had? It was a proper slut. Oh shit, you can't talk about that.
Everyone's got skeletons.
They properly became brethren, and then because of your friend's breakup. You never even saw them.
It's a bit
like, he was onto his next missus. Oh. You were like, oh yeah, this is the next one. You're like, oh, she's gonna be, I'm gonna have to be bridges with her. Fucking hell.
The worst is when your mate gets married and has kids and then you never see your mate again. Like your mate just vanishes because they've had kids and you're like, where's my mate?
Oh, you know, the missus, I can't come out.
The worst is when your mate is going out with a girl and then they kind of break up. And then you're there and your mate's there going, yeah, fuck her, man. She ain't worth it. You know, fuck this bitch. Yeah. She's an idiot. Fuck that bitch. I knew she was a snake. I knew she was a snake. I could tell from the beginning. And then next week they get back together.
Oh, yeah.
And you're like,
yeah,
you've released all this poison into the air.
I just said that to make you feel that she's really cool, man. She's completely safe.
I only said that to make him feel better. You know what I mean? Anyway, like, yeah, that's fuckeries. But you know what? Before we go off, we usually have a section here, the wackest writer of the week.
Oh, shit.
Graph-wise, yeah. But I don't have a wackest writer. Because Talal is with us here, my brother, and he's a budding stand-up comedian, same as theme right here.
But this could go on. This could go on for a long time. This chat.
Yeah, I know, but I'm just gonna put it out there.
I want to go and get a beer from the shop before it closes.
Go grab a beer.
Oh, can I go as well?
Oh, from the shop. No. Not from the shop. Nah,
take me like 5 minutes.
No. This is only going to be 5 minutes. We're gonna shut this down in a minute.
Yeah. Well, can I quickly go?
Talal.
See, he's getting a beer. What the fuck? Yes. That's it. End of the podcast.
He's not going to the shop. God damn it. He's going to the fridge.
Yeah, but I can go up at the bottom of my road.
No. Themas.
Take me minutes.
No, chill.
Minutes.
Chill. Because by the time you're back, we're done. All right.
I finished this fucking ages ago, man. I should have bought two.
Come on. Let's go. Come on.
Is that your perk up speech?
Yeah, let's go.
Come on. Get in line.
There's people listening now. There's people listening, and I hope they leave a comment on the video. Let us know what's going on. But anyway, leave us a review and a rating. But no, while we're waiting for Talal to come back, I wanted to say, like, you know, we have a wackest writer of the week. This time, I wanted to do wackest comedian of the week. I have a name.
This guy must have really pissed you off.
He didn't piss me off. It's just he's really popular and a lot of people like this guy and he's been around for years. But for me, he's just a cheap knockoff of other people who are better. And I just find him really fucking annoying, man. And
none of his show... shit is well written.
Listen,
it's just for shock value and shit.
I gotta put the disclaimer out there. This is a matter of opinion. This isn't me saying the be all end all of everything. No, the world will keep spinning, and everything.
You've got to be American and 13 to like this guy and think he's cool. Look what he's doing, man! He's vomiting on the table. Oh my god!
Okay, so let me just say,
you've got to be American.
So now Talal's back with us. I want to say the wackest comedian of the week for me is Eric Andre. He's an American. He's an American comedian. He's a shock comedian. He's got the Eric Andre show. I think he's a stand-up as well. I'm sure he's done some stand-up or whatever. He seems like a nice guy. I've seen him in interviews and everything. But when I watch his comedy, I think it's just a shitty, cheap laughs.
Toilet humor, dog shit.
Shock humor. And I like shock humor when it's got some sort of substance to it. But for him, when I watch him...
wow. It's going to definitely leave.
Yeah. It just seems like it's just like, let's just do it for the sake of doing it and get a cheap laugh. I don't like him. I don't know. What do you guys think?
Is that it? Is that all you've got to say about
him? I've only checked him out today.
Just Eric Andre. Look, I'm trying to think of examples who are better than him.
I watched a few things today of the series.
Wait. Themos. I will get to that. 1 second. I think Bottom with Rick Mayall.
Rick Mayall and Aid Edmondson.
That's like, you know... off key humor,
very well written,
punching and slapping and like, what's it called, Talal, with the humor where you fall down on a
slapstick
banana. Slapstick humor,
said,
you know what I mean? Stuff
he
like
asked
that.
Me. It's called slapstick.
Yeah, sorry, T. Sorry.
Ah, okay, slapstick.
Sorry.
I'm trying to think of other
slap
examples.
My dick, slapstick. Had to.
Even fucking Noel's House Party, I prefer it to fucking Eric Andre show.
All right, Ahmed. So now you're just,
Noel's
you've lost your mind
party.
Now. What are you talking about? Yeah. Noel fucking...
Noel's House Party?
Yeah.
What the fuck is his name?
I remember that.
Noel's House Party is better.
Where they slime people and shit.
Yeah.
You're going to get covered in a bucket of slime.
It wasn't about
they would
slimy.
Prank people.
It was
they
Mr. Would have, Blobby. That have... shit. That was the shit. That was the best.
Now, but do you remember as well, they had this hidden camera where they would project into someone's house and they would, like, you know, do hidden camera shit. That shit was funny as fuck.
Or they had a camera and they'd install a camera into someone's TV set. And they would like watch them watching the show and like play pranks on them, like talk to the family at home, and then they would show everyone watching what how their reactions were.
Maddie, I just you think can't Eric compare Andre, Eric is Andre cheap.
To Noel's house party. What are you doing?
Yes, I can. Yes, I can.
What have you seen of Eric Andre's?
No, I think Eric, I saw some of his, not stand-up, his show, his TV, his where he hosts the show. And I thought it was shit. I thought he's just like deliberately trying to make it really sort of chaotic, not involving the guests. The guests think they come in, he just doesn't even slag them off, like barely talks to them, vomits on the desk, smashes the desk up with a chainsaw. Like the first thing that would ever come in your head when you're very young, what would be really funny if I smashed the desk, and then don't sort of work on it anymore? It's that. He doesn't work in it anymore. And he's just, I'll try and make the guests feel really uncomfortable by being a fucking weirdo.
Yeah.
That's what
that
I thought.
Basically
about.
The essence of it.
That's it.
I love that he has, I love that he has like a bunch of old white men as his band. I love that he has the band that he throws to every now and then.
He has, what's his name? Reggie Watts is his
not
band.
Reggie Watts. No. That's James Corden. Reggie Watts. No, it's not Reggie Watts.
No, it is the Eric Andre. Oh no, it's not. Yeah, you're right. You're right. Sorry.
It's like these old. It's like an old white.
I'm thinking of Comedy Bang Bang. I'm thinking of Comedy Bang Bang. Sorry.
The things I've seen of Eric Andre's show. What do you think? Are basically clips on YouTube, because we don't get that show here in the UK. But we've seen clips of it on YouTube. It's an Adult Swim show, isn't it? And it's only like. See, the good thing about Adult Swim is their shows are 11 minutes long. They're not like long, drawn out things. So,
no, I love Rick and Morty. Rick and Morty is 22, 21 minutes long.
But also, like, what? You're so basic, Maddie.
It's
intelligent. It's really intelligent comedy, Mr. Rick and Morty. But, like, Eric Andre. the clips I've seen on YouTube, I think some of it is like really unique and like stuff you've never seen before. Yeah, he chainsaws his desk, and it's the thing that you wished you could do as a teenager, but no one's actually done it. Like, he does ridiculous fucking shit.
Yeah, they have, Talal. No, people have done it before.
And I've heard, I haven't watched it, but he made a movie, and I've heard amazing things.
Talal, what? I'm sorry, I'm going to interject one second. What? You said it hasn't been done before. Have you ever heard of someone called Tom Green?
Yeah, this is the my Tom bum is on Green
lips.
Show.
My bum it's is on your lips. Green my Tom bum show. Is on your lips.
It is my
Have
favorite show.
Have you ever seen
show
his show?
Because
this
it
was
is
like
my show.
Years, a decade before Eric Andre fucking.
I'm sure
Pussy
Tom Green is one of Eric Andre's idols.
Pussy.
I'm sure.
Yeah, I'm sure he is as well, because Tom Green has done everything before Eric Andre did it. Tom Green
that's
did it 10
point.
Years before.
That's a good point, Maddie.
Without any of the fucking. Yeah. That's so that's what I'm saying. Everyone,
that's
I hear
all
so
comedy
many.
Though, as well.
I hear so many people bigging
Maddie,
up Eric
kids,
Andre.
I've never heard of Tom
it's
Green.
It's been done.
Have Eric Andre. And.
Fuck him.
I'm just saying, I've seen some clips of his that I'm like, whatever. I've seen clips of his where I'm like, whoa, that was fucking shocking. That was pretty cool. But it hasn't it hasn't compelled me to go out and watch full episodes of his show. But I will say...
His movie? He's got a movie.
Yeah, I just said
well.
That.
I never haven't watched
it. He had a movie out. I haven't watched it, but I've heard really, really good things about that film, and I really want to see it.
Yeah, by idiots.
I don't think by idiots. Okay, people have cool. said like no. that he did something some really I bet you it's better than the sequel to Borat. I bet you it's better than that.
No, that's good.
It was good to Borat. But I think like it's going to be quite
and good. That's a good thing you brought up Borat. Borat is another he because the thing is with Borat there's one level of just an idiot chatting shit with people
fucking
he there's wait.
Yes.
There's layers, and then he's exposing racism.
There's no intelligence to Eric Andre.
And he's... Eric Andre is just being an idiot.
It's
anarchic. It's like, okay, but...
It's anarchic.
But be original. I don't think he's original. You're saying that, oh, he's doing stuff that's never been seen before. No, I've seen it before.
No, I think within the tiny niche...
Fucking...
Yeah, that's a niche genre.
No, I've seen it.
It's a very anarchic chat show. It's a very niche genre. And I think he's earned his spot within that genre. But what I will say is that his segment in have you seen Jackass Forever, the new Jackass film?
Yeah.
His segment in that was quite funny. He was pretty funny.
What happened in that segment? Remind me, because I have seen it.
I don't remember him being in it.
He's in it, I know. Well, what happened, Talal? You don't even remember.
They pranked the fuck out of him, and it was really funny. And his reaction was funny.
What, getting a coffee and they blasted him in the face?
Yeah.
It's like 2 seconds. It's like, and it's not even anything to do with his comedic genius. It's just they got a prick.
His reaction was quite funny. I think he takes part in one of the pranks. But I like his personality. I think he's quite an interesting guy. But okay.
I reckon he's an interesting guy.
I don't hold him to esteem.
You know, he went out with, what's her name, who was in the new Mandalorian, the girl with the fit girl, Rosa something. She was in Clerks and all them ones.
I don't know Rosario, anything about shit like that.
Rosario Dawson. Ooh. A theme. You will recognize her if I showed you a picture of her. But they went out for a while.
Wow,
and that's the only time I respected... That was the only time I respected Eric Andre, was when I heard that he was going out with her. I was like, oh, okay. He must
What's
be
her
a,
name? Rosaria
Rosario Dawson. Yeah, she's a Yeti.
All right, theme, who's yours?
She was in Kids.
Yeah.
She was in Kids.
Exactly, yeah, when she was a kid. Yes.
As soon as I saw her face, I clocked that she was in Kids.
She's loosey goosey. Go on then, theme. What's your, what's your whack comedian of the week?
No, we're not going to go round in a circle.
No, we're done. It's one person.
Yeah, we're done.
Maddie's. I fully agree, though. You should press the arm house to your mum's house button on fucking Eric Andre, the pussy.
Who signed your guitar? Comedian
of the week.
Oh, that's Don.
I don't like this guitar being in the background. Because
it's always there.
I'm a snob. But it's because of the one I don't use. So the ones I use.
Did you tag it?
Tell him.
Don.
No, who? Yeah.
No, Don.
Who's that?
From Q York.
What's that?
Don from Q York. Yeah, Talal. Like Don's
Don
a
from Q York. You don't even know Talal. Talal doesn't know, man.
He's a sick letter writer, man.
Legendary.
From, like, you know, around Richmond and
from
shit.
The 80s.
Smashed the district
from the
line.
80s.
Yeah, smashed it.
Don
he's
is
still
a...
Like, with like Coochie and Nerve and all of the GFS lot.
Yo, have you seen Don's...
He's a sick artist now, Talal, man. He's a sick artist. Now.
You'll recognize his art. I'll send you some stuff of his. Cool. But have you seen his Instagram when he's...
Go on.
No, because his Instagram, Don, he loves showing off his bare chest. He's got like a really, he's like quite ripped. Yeah, he's quite built.
Yeah, he looks like Wolverine.
Yeah. And so he's always, any chance he has, he gets his nips out. And he's always on his Instagram.
Do you guys like Rick Rock or Risk Rock?
That rings a bell.
Rick
what is
Risk.
Risk. Not Rick Ross.
He's a Risk is his tag. He's from LA. He's like an OG graph guy from LA. He writes Risk.
Oh, I think I know the guy you're talking about. The guy you sent me a video like a while
ago.
Yeah,
he's very active on
Instagram.
But he has this one piece that, like, if I could have like a miracle lottery wish, it would be to get this fucking piece he made, man. His tag is...
Let us know what his Instagram... What is his
Instagram? Tag? His Instagram is...
I know...
His Instagram is...
Talal.
I'm about to tell you.
I know about three...
Such brotherly love.
Literally about to tell you the answer to your question.
I know
about three.
Three people who write Risk right now.
His Instagram is Risk Rock. That's one of
how
his...
do you spell rock? R-O-C? R-O-K? Like, come on.
I don't know.
Tal,
how do you spell
out?
Rock, Maddie? Who has a learning disability? It's rock. R-O-C-K. Rock. Risk.
Talal, we're talking about hip-hop spellings.
Spelled correctly.
Hip-hop spellings, Talal, can be anything, all right? So don't give me that shit, all right, man?
But he made this fucking... His tag is just... I don't know.
He's a toy.
Every now and then, I'll like... I make fun of like graffiti sometimes. Like I'll make fun of graffiti writers and their indistinguishable passion for something that seems to be so simplistic,
so stupid,
and silly.
Yeah.
It's just like
don't touch my graph stuff.
Yeah.
But then you see like a thing.
This guy,
you'll see like the way someone writes a word and you go, oh, I get it. Like it's just Here it is.
Most people don't. You only do that because your brother writes. Most people don't even do that.
Like when someone, like, you know, you just write a word. And I do see it with Amber, not so much with you, Theme, but like when I see Amber, like the way some, when Maddie's done a really good piece, I'm like, wow, I fucking get it. That is fucking stunning. Yeah. Like just the way you've shaped those letters. I don't know if it's a choice or if it's just impulse or if it's just the way your hand moved in that moment. I don't know, but the, it just comes together and you're like, wow, that looks absolutely, like it just blows my mind sometimes. Yeah. And then other times I fucking hate it. You know, fuck this risk. I'm looking for this thing I want to show you.
No, no, you're chatting whilst you're looking
at this thing. Way down in
we're going to do 5 minutes on Eric Andre. I'm going to get a beer. It's fucking 11:15.
I want to just tell you one thing. I just want to say one thing. I want to ask you one thing. About. I have a graph question.
Go on.
I have a graph question.
Fuck's
sake. Go hit me.
Oh, but there it is. There's the risk. Like, it just looks really
that's
cool.
That's so shit.
The way
no, that looks
it.
Shit.
Does it look shit?
I'm sorry. It looks terrible. It looks super toy.
I think you need to look at it.
I'm
not even trying to fuck
one of those pens that has like multicolored tips at the same time and you write your tail.
No, that wasn't with a pen. No, that's a sculpture.
Okay, that looks like...
Yeah, I know!
That's a sculpture.
That looks like you don't need to tell us.
Okay, but the other one looked like it was on a freight train. It looked like on a freight.
Yeah.
Yeah, the other picture you showed up.
That was an old school picture.
That isn't. Yeah, I can't see shit on your screen, Talal. It looks terrible. But before you flash
fuck
up another...
Fuck Eric Andre and fuck Risk.
Yeah.
Risk is now going down as the wackest graph writer of the week.
No.
I'd love you to do him as whack writer of the week. Go and look him up. Risk Rock. And then next week, talk about him.
No.
We're doing him right now.
We're doing it right
now. No. Risk. Look him up. Look him up before you do that.
Wackest writer of the week. What's his Instagram, Talal? Remind me.
Risk Rock.
Yeah, is the
really funky came up with rock, you know, like rock.
Yeah, oh
Risk
my
rock.
God, oh my God,
no one's done that.
He's a pussy and he's shit.
He's the wackest writer of the fucking year,
wackest writer of the week. Risk
he does these amazing.
All right,
he does these amazing.
Fuck it, fuck.
He does these amazing Instagram lives, and he interviewed this old cholo writer, like Mexican gang writer. Who was from the 50s and 60s, was one of the first people to do like graph as we know it today. And he would use shoe polish to graph on the side of the LA River and shit. And he was showing him he was like talking him through how he does his tags and about how important the lettering is and stuff. And I was sitting there going, whoa, like I've never thought about it scientifically like this guy's talking about it. But this is a guy who 50 years ago, I'm sure he wasn't thinking about it that way. He was just doing a thing, but now he's had decades to analyze the shit he did, and he was famous for drawing this like cool skull image. I sent it to you, Maddie, at the time. But, like,
I remember you sending it to me. I did check it out, I can't remember the name of the cholo.
Writes his tag next to it, but he's like this cholo grapher. Yeah. Like before, like people even knew what graffiti was. It was before like style wars and shit. Like 20 years before that shit, he was doing it.
Yeah.
And
yeah, that's dope. Like, but you know, Risk. He's a
no, he's not. So Maddie, good. Risk is like 20 years older than you.
I know.
Like, you want to look that shit
I'm obviously kidding.
But anyway, what I wanted to ask you, because I thought, I forgot.
I need to go to the fucking
You were like whack writer of the week, and then you were going to do whack comedian of the week. And I thought it goes around the circle, but it doesn't. You just pick one. But I was going to do, as an inverse, I was going to pick a graph guy and like surprise you with it. Yeah. But I wanted to talk about 10 foot.
Oh shit!
Because he
as the wackest.
I remember you rating him, and I'm like,
no wait, Talal, as the wackest writer.
Yes, in my kind of twist, like yes, as the wackest writer. Shit. Because I remember you rating him, like Maddie, you love 10 foot.
Oh shit!
Oh, and he's gone. I remember you saying you were rating him, but I've seen him everywhere. And is that why you rate him? Because he's everywhere.
Yeah.
Because his style isn't anything to really. Right home.
His style
about.
Is very basic. It's very it's basic. He does do
than
bits.
Basic.
Yeah, but he does do. But because if you're gonna do that much graph all over the town in that abundance. Yeah. You have to have a simple style that you can whip out quick and on any surface at any time.
Yeah, he needs to be able and to he's whip it worked out, like out. African butter's dick, yeah?
Yeah.
Like African butter.
So he's worked out this style that he can do quick time, similar to
but
writers.
It's not
like
a style. It's just like writing. It's just his handwriting. It's not a style.
Yeah, because you haven't seen all his stuff. Yeah, a lot of his stuff is just capital letters, top to bottom. Let's just be seen. Boom, I'm on a bridge. I'm going to just do my tag.
He's talking about
tags. Yeah.
No, there's one outside my window. I can see it from my balcony here. It says 10 foot. And then you see it on the motorway when you're driving and shit. It's just like handwriting. It looks like my fucking school textbook.
Yeah, capital letters, yeah. But that's because you're seeing him in bait areas. The guy has obviously shown and proved that he can do. I've never seen a wild style piece from him. I'm not trying to say that. Mm-hmm. But if someone is that active, and we spoke about this on the other episode, me and Theme, there's different categories you can respect the writer.
Well, yeah.
That you can respect someone who's only ever painted three pieces in their life, but those three pieces were so fucking stylistically amazing, they fall into the Don style category. And then you have a category of a guy who's just batters London, who's everywhere. His style is shit or whatever you can think of, but he's literally everywhere. So you gotta give him respect on the gumption alone. You know, and then there's other writers who, you know, their placement, you know, they might not have batted everywhere or been around everywhere or whatever, but when they catch a thing, they do it in a spot that catches everyone's
eye. How did
they
get there?
Yeah, or whatever. So there's that type of respect. So there's so many different categories, and definitely.
Do you remember that old video game, Getting Up? It was a graffiti computer game.
Yeah, yeah.
And you
of
get
course.
It was the point of it was to they get in the maddest reaches. Like you have to climb this and then walk across this wire, and then you can get the mad points by getting the reach and the mad.
The angel spots. The angel spots.
That
the heaven
game was
spots.
Sick. Yeah, and it had a sick soundtrack with the mad hip hop music. But because when I was younger, I remember Tox. Tox was everywhere. Is he still around?
Tox was the man. He's still around. Yes.
You don't see it as around, much. Not though. He's like semi-retired.
Not as active.
And then nowadays, you've got 10 foot and Helch have kind of taken the Tox spot. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Pretty much.
But Helch.
I mean, what do you think, Theme? Theme. You think 10 foot took the Tox spot or what?
In the genre the of spot. Like just getting about graffiti.
I thought you said the top spot.
No, the Tox spot.
The Tox.
Yeah.
Like not the...
That's called bombing.
Yeah, like the bombing genre of graffiti. Not like the amazing pieces, like, but like they are everywhere.
Yeah, getting up.
Helch and 10 foot, right? You see them everywhere.
Yeah, yeah.
I think Helch was first, and now 10 foot is taking... is coming up.
Helch is kind of another thing because Helch does rollers and you know, obviously he does do spray paint stuff, but
sometimes you'll see it like
he
sprayed it out
but...
of a fire extinguisher. Like you can see just like
But
what the final point is, and now I'm gonna be done after I finish this. Helch now has like elevated to where he's actually good. So like unlike 10 foot, like you'll see a Helch and you're like, oh wait, that's actually really clean. And that
you can't compare the two, Talal, because Helch does roller. He uses roller paint.
Okay, fine. But
and
Helch started
uses spray paint.
Yeah, but Helch also just does like sprays and also does like fire extinguisher ones where he's like spraying up on a bridge.
Yeah, but he mainly does roller.
Okay, but now you'll
stuff.
See a Helch
and you now
where it's just the H, and it's like the most beautiful it. H you've ever seen. Like it's just like. A gorgeous
yeah, but it's
square.
A different skill, Talal.
Huh?
It's a different skill. It's a different skill.
I know, but I'm just, I find
different
it because,
skill set.
But they both had they all had Tox, 10 foot, Helch. Their thing was, I'm everywhere. Like, that was their thing. It was like, I don't care the quality, I'm everywhere.
Yeah.
And Tox kind of disappeared. And now you've got
you
10 foot and Helch.
Helch. So what you're saying
and now, Helch is like actually. Up. I'm everywhere, and it's top quality as well. And I just find it really interesting to see that evolution.
I think...
Well, there's different... It's an interesting point of view because you're coming from this, what you see on the train and the motorway and shit. That's what you're talking... Because you don't do graph. So that, you know, you're bang on in that. I'd say I don't really... think that most of the 10-foot stuff, most of his stuff you haven't seen, we haven't seen, that you get mad.
Where is it then, in his fucking living room? What do you mean we haven't seen it? Where is
it? I'll tell you now.
On trains. And it gets buffed.
No, wait, guys, yeah. guys. In Paddington, when you're coming into Paddington Station from Ealing and you're going into Paddington, on the right-hand side, there's a big wall of bare pieces and dubs, and there's a 10-foot right at the end, right before you hit Paddington, just before the bridge, there's a 10-foot, and it's got mad style to it. He even painted it in a way that it looks like it's zinging across the thing. I'm not saying it was like some crazy groundbreaking thing. No. And I don't think he's trying to. Like we said, his motivation is getting up, getting as
I've seen good styles on panels.
But he does have... He's limited to his style. He's limited. I've not seen him really stray far off of his standard outline. I've seen, you know, that standard outline. But ultimately, if you're a marketeer, if you're an advertiser, the whole point is branding and getting that point out there, getting it boom, 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 boom on as many places as possible in a nice enough fashion that it's eloquent to the eye. And I think that 10-foot pulls that off. He's not
10-foot has done way more bits than really? Helch.
Yeah,
like millions and millions.
I think I agree. I think I've seen more 10-foots than Helch.
It's because 10-foot in Australia, no, France, yeah, Croatia, he's all, yeah, like everywhere.
Yeah, but man, he was never on the front Helch cover hasn't of the done Sun, any... was he?
Well, yeah, no, Helch but, was. But the thing is, their techniques are so different. When you're rolling the thing out,
yeah.
Compared
obviously,
to painting it with spray paint, sure, it's two completely.
Well, imagine
different
bombing with a roller, like that's even more impressive in a way. But
it is. But you have to kind of pick.
Andy,
your spot,
you're being
girl,
really
we're gonna do that.
Kind of downbeat about it. Are you 10-foot?
No, I'm not. I don't want to say anything about.
He wishes.
I can tell. Shut. I he can tell that. It. What's going on?
Yeah.
If he was 10-foot, he wouldn't be here right now. He'd be out painting somewhere. That's what they fucking do. That's what they fucking do.
It is very impressive how prolific they are. And I can see a Helch and a 10-foot from my window from this flat that I'm house sitting in. It's impressive as hell.
Yeah.
But I am also, though.
He's a different character.
But what I have noticed, all I'm saying is, I've noticed Tox is disappearing or disappeared ages ago.
Yeah.
10-foot is everywhere, but Helch has improved. I've actually seen an evolution in Helch's style, and I'm very happy with that because at first, Helch was kind of laughable, but now I see one of his H's, and I'm like, that's actually a really
instantly
recognizable, nice, clean, beautiful little H, and I'm just kind of like...
He stepped up. It's
pretty. A beautiful
I know, it's weird, but it's really pretty. Right. You see it, and it's pretty as fuck.
He uses.
You've got to imagine as well. He's doing like with sort of 18, 20-foot.
But it's
poles.
A perfect square. You know what I mean? How
at
do you
the
do
top? A well, like wobbly.
And that's your 10,000 hours. He's done his 10,000 hours of practice, and he's now perfected the art form. And like,
Talal. Also, Talal. Next time you see a Helch thing, look at the wall he's doing it on. Is it a brick wall? If you look at the bricks and you look at the letter, the way he spaces it out, if you actually count the bricks,
is he using them as a guide?
Yes, man, of course.
Well,
he
good
is
good for him. That's very clever.
Yeah,
fantastic.
Of course, I'm just saying, like, it's not willy-nilly. The dude is precision because he's using the contours on the wall that he's using. That's the beauty of graph, is you use your surroundings, you know. And that's why I love when I see a Helch thing, I look at the actual wall and I'm like, oh, okay, so he squared it off using those lines. And because me too, when I look at him, I'm like, how does he get it so fucking precise, you know? And then if you actually look at it,
that's great.
You can see how he...
Mate,
he
when I was a kid at school, I would buy like lined paper or like grid, a book of like lined paper or grid paper, and I wouldn't understand the point of them. The lines. I would just like
do that S. Yeah. You'd probably
I'd draw everywhere.
You should do that S.
I wouldn't get that three what, lines. That's what the lines are for. I would just write my handwriting was so shit. Whereas Helch gets
that's because you're
he's like the grid's there
that's
for a reason, man.
That's because you're an idiot. I'm a toy. So now, party people in the... No, I'm just kidding. Talal, I love you.
I love you too, guys. Maddie. I love you, Andy. Thank you. You're really fucking cool and funny and amazing. And I want to come to your next gig. Have you got any gigs coming up, Andy?
Oh.
No, I haven't because I've been doing so
much. Well, let's do one together soon. Find an open mic that's a bringer and then let's do it together or something. That would be really cool.
And then we'll let people know on the podcast and people hopefully
that would be brilliant. Yeah,
we'll come and support and show some love.
I want to go and try
some
new shit. I've got a couple new bits that I need to try out. So let's do something. And my final, before we end, my final report on how the show's going as your producer. Maddie, your shit that you say where you're like, leave a comment and a like and shit, save that for the end. You do that at the end and that's the only time you do it. Because the people who listen to the show and actually care about the show are listening till the end. And that they're the ones...
Yeah, but they don't leave comments though. They don't be leaving comments.
Well, then
that's
don't
why I need
say
to
it at the beginning because they're not going to keep listening. They're going to be like, oh, this is a podcast about leaving comments. I don't want to listen to it. So don't make that the first thing you say. You say hello and fair you get enough. Into the good shit. You don't say it at the top of the show. You save it to the end. Maybe you do a little break in the middle if you want.
All right, Talal, we should talk about this off air.
No, this
I
is me doing my producer's report.
The end.
Other than that, I'm very proud to have you as part of this. To have you as part of the Stupid Noises family.
Stupid Noises.
I'm very grateful to be your first guest on the show. I can't believe it. So thank you very much. I'm a big fan. I love the show. And I can't wait to see where it goes. You guys are great. You're really good at this. You're naturals at this. So keep it up. I know we've run over so much today. Fuck me.
It's all good. Freestyle. No, it's good. It's good. Yeah. It's good. Themos, have you got anything to add before I round it up?
No, but we've got guests in the pipeline. I've got a voice note from Michael Parkinson because I asked him if he wants to come on. I don't know what he says.
What the?
Genesis Elijah says he's coming on.
Who's Michael Parkinson?
Talal thinks Michael Parkinson. He thinks the original.
Parky.
No, not Parkinson.
Not the guy who invented interviews and shit.
No. He's a hip-hop
Michael Parkinson, the producer.
Yeah. I was very confused about that last episode because he kept bringing him up and I was like, this is a funny bit that Andy's doing. I thought that was a funny joke.
Genesis Elijah. No.
Yeah.
And who was the other one who reached out to the Killer Keller, said we're going to go and feature on his podcast.
Yo, I think we might go.
And we, that Killer would be Keller, sick. They'll talk about the podcast.
Yeah. Because theme, that's the thing. When you have a new podcast, the way to get new followers, and I don't know what
is
Talal
going on another
doing.
Podcast.
What's Talal's cross doing?
I'm showing you the folder tattoo that you talked about last episode.
Oh yeah, folder. No, but but Talal, your image is so shit.
That's it. I'm gonna get buy a fucking beer. It's like 11.
No, we're going
31.
Oh, wait. Theme, wait.
The shop's blatantly going to be. I'm going to be so fuming. I'm going to send you the worst voice.
But
note
you
of your
said
life
last
the
episode that you would, I would show you the tattoo.
I know.
That mum's eyebrow tattooist gave her.
Yeah, the eyebrow.
Oh, this is it.
From the
however,
eyebrow.
A little
tattoo.
Correction. She wasn't just willy nilly.
Still fucking there.
She wasn't just like, I'll give you a tattoo. She was really scared because she was like, she's super Muslim. The woman who tattooed my mum's eyebrows. Super Islamic.
See.
She said, if my husband knows that I tattooed on a man, I'll get into his trouble. Basically, like he'll beat the shit out of her, basically. And then we were like, we won't tell anyone, don't worry, your secret's safe with us. And then she was
podcast,
like, okay.
Like, hey.
And then she did it in permanent. It's not she did so mum's eyebrows were in henna. Ink. So this is something very typical that Arab women do is they get henna tattoo on their eyebrows, but they do it with a traditionally with a stick and poke or with a tattoo gun, but it's henna ink, so it disappears after a while. Whereas my tattoo, I was like, do you have any permanent ink? And she said, yeah,
she did it permanent.
And I said, let me get a tattoo. And then mum was trying to say no, and then I said, well, mum, I just watched her tattoo your face, you can't tell me I can't get one. But I'll let you be involved. You can write the word. And we were watching the TV at the time. She was on the sofa and the TV was on. And it was the 1 year anniversary of the Egyptian uprising. And that's why I chose to have the word revolution tattooed on my arm with mum's handwriting. But the word revolution has blood.
Yeah, your screen is really pixelated. I can't
make
it.
It'll be fine
out,
in the upload. The blood, there's blood coming out of the word. Revolution
there's like drips.
Thawra. Thawra.
There's drips of blood coming out of it. And that's the full story of the tattoo. So the tattooist was very
to make it more revolutionized
about doing it. And so I have mum's handwriting. I have a picture of dad drawn by Maddie as my other tattoo. Yeah. That's another story.
Let's not go through all your tattoos. Like,
but I need a tattoo, something to do with Shahla and Lulu, and then I'll have the whole family on my arm. So that's the next tattoo I need to get.
All right, but Talal, did the woman, the tattooist, the one who did mum's eyebrows, did she end up getting beaten up by her?
Oh, yeah. Oh, mate. Fucking hell. Next time she came round, she had like three teeth missing. Her eye socket was like, she broke her eyes.
She had a tattoo on her own fucking eyebrows. Yeah, she was fucked.
No. Respect to her.
We were honest to her and we didn't fucking tell her husband, obviously, and she was fine.
Yeah. This is like over 10 years ago. Yeah. But listen, guys, much love. Thank you so much, man. Thank everyone for listening. Is it all right to plug the all the stuff now, Talal? Is now the time to do it?
Now's the time. Follow me. I'm Talalaban and listen to the Alexis Sale podcast. Thank you.
Alexis Sale podcast. Make sure you check that out, man. The music on that is done by Tarbush Records, man. We got my man Theme at Real Theme on Instagram.
And if you like Dungeons and Dragons, check out Vicky's World, the podcast. Thank you.
Vicky's World. I doubt anyone watching this is going to be into Dungeons and Dragons, but respect
to you. If you like Games Workshop painting the figures, check out So Damn Fresh on Instagram.
So Damn Fresh 1.
Yeah.
So Damn
That's
Fresh
the other
1.
Reason why, that's why KRS had the 1 at the end of his name, because he couldn't. There was another KRS.
No, but Talal, we spoke about maybe doing a Dungeons and Dragons, but in a hip-hop universe.
Yeah.
Where I haven't chatted to Theme about this, but maybe we
this
could
guy
do...
and hip hop man, like everything,
so
you know,
we could everything. So no, but we could do a
maybe we do that an
hip-hop.
Episode of yes. Arms House. I'll run a game for you two.
Talal is a dungeon master.
We'll do a one
shot. Incredible at that. Theme has never done it before. Anyway,
doesn't matter.
Let's not get into
we'll
this
set
now.
This up. This is a great idea.
We will set this up. This is a great I think that idea. Would be incredible to do one episode where we do a Dungeons and Dragons, but a graffiti Dungeons and Dragons episode. Anyway, moving on, guys. Thank
All
you.
Right, I'm up for it.
Thank you so much. No, I don't care if you're up for it. You're doing it anyway.
I said I'm up for it.
I know. I'm just kidding.
All you gotta say is Arms House to Your Mom's House drops every Wednesday. Big up all the listeners and please check it out every time
Play
it drops.
Thing, Maddie. Yeah. What is that
Much
from?
Love party people.
Arms House to your mum's to your mom's house.